over this, but the ones that were in, the drawings that were in our package showed a distance of the, I guess probably estimated or semi-estimated distance from the corner of the house to the BVW line of 19 feet. Did we interpret that correctly?
I went out and measured all that, so you got my notes. They were put in the packet by mistake, so whatever that said.
Oh, all right, yeah, 19 feet.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Okay, but you say that the tree is 17 feet.
It's from, the tree is 17 feet from the BVW.
BVW.
Right, not from the house.
I didn't measure from the house to the tree.
That would mean that tree was 2 feet from the house. And it's a lot more than 2 feet from the house.
Yeah, it's about a foot from the
which one we're
wall.
Talking about here?
17.
Number 17?
Or the one
17 is, oh, sorry. 17 is 17 feet from the BVW. And that mark that's right there, what is it? It's like 8 because it gets closer, doesn't it, in that area? I don't have the notes. You guys have them. That's from the corner of the house to the retaining wall.
If there were two people walking side by side, you would have to be careful.
Between the corner of the house and the retaining
wall.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Right,
yes.
And
one little area there.
Right,
it's narrow.
And I remember that. And that, at that point, the bordering vegetated wetland is 19 feet from the corner of the house.
I didn't measure from the corner of the house to the bordering vegetated. Let me see the notes.
Yeah,
the one you're talking about, James, didn't you call that a river birch? Like kind of a rough bark to it?
We saw a river birch in there. I can't say for sure
split.
It was that one.
The one was kind of split. And I
there
think that's the one we're talking
we
about.
We had somebody come out to the house. I don't know if I'm watching. We had somebody come out to the house yesterday, and he looked at all the trees. And the one that does split and has sort of a hole in the
mm-hmm.
front part.
Right.
He said he didn't know, but that it's possible that once you get up there and he looks down, that it might be,
I wouldn't be surprised.
These aren't, this is just notes. I don't know what that is. I wrote
okay.
on the back of a
okay.
piece of paper.
So you're saying,
that's what's the
you're
notes
saying go
from
by
my
the
site.
Colored
that might have been what
paper.
I did in the office.
Okay.
Well, we estimated the distance from the corner of the house to the boring vegetated wetlands is somewhere between 15 and 25 feet. It's pretty close.
Yeah, it's that corner, yeah.
15 or 20.
Yeah. Okay,
I'm
sorry.
I'm just wondering what that middle tree is, though. I mean, I always thought we talked about two trees in the back. So.
Well, they were the two fairly, right, that big
further out.
Norwood maples, very close to the retaining wall.
That's the two right in the middle of this picture.
Right. The one that's 7 feet and the one that's 17 feet?
No, the two that are 14.
Oh, okay, all right.
Those are those two Norways. The 17 is what I think is that river birch. And I think the first one is that real leaner. Definitely that.
Right.
Okay.
I just don't know what the other one is. Did you, is there a third?
There's the one that the owl was hanging off of.
Oh, I remember that.
That's the one where there was this dead branch when we first moved yep. in. And a while ago, and I guess I don't remember.
Yeah, you can see.
And then there's two parts kind of coming out from there. But that one's pretty close to the wall. That I think that's another one. That, I don't know what kind of tree it is.
James,
but you do recall another tree out there
this
you were worried about.
Is from
through
the back.
The leaner and one near.
We were actually the gentleman was talking to us about a tree that was further out behind that, and he was. It splits like this. One goes this way, sort of towards the house, and one goes in the other direction. And he thought that the one going out towards her house, that whole thing should be taken off.
Yeah, I think I remember that one. That's probably what that is.
This was not.
This
is 8 feet from the back.
Backwards, right?
This is 13 feet, and then whatever that is from the house. So that would be there.
Okay.
Yeah.
From
okay.
many angles.
So just to sort of summarize, it sounds like there's at least one dead tree. The one that's 35 feet plus or minus, is that's the one with the dead branch?
That tree is growing in a bunch of stone. So if it gets any bigger, it's gonna fall over on its own. So it just kind of establish itself in a kind of a stone wall.
But that's the one way out by the property line. You said you probably weren't gonna bother with
that. We're not gonna bother with it.
So the one that broke this last weekend is in between that and those two other Norways.
Okay, so it looks like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
No, that's not the one that broke.
The last one's not gonna go. We're not gonna bother.
Okay, the last one's not
going.
So
no,
five.
The one that broke is in between
five trees.
Two
that's way out here.
And some shrubs. Or
saplings.
This is the property line here.
And this is the sapling area.
There's
the blue,
a broken one.
The 10 slap.
It was like on her lawn.
Hauling tank.
I have no problems with the Norway maples going. I have no problems with the dead one going and the broken one going. So for me, you know. And then this one here is very close to the corner of the house. So if it gets any bigger. And close to the wall as well.
Okay.
I will vote to allow cutting those trees. But I have a problem that the prior commission approved a house 19 feet from the Boring Bridge State Wetlands. I have a big problem with that.
Well, it's water over the dam.
It's water over the dam. But let's not let that same water go over any more dams. Let's make sure
that
if we allow something even within 35 feet, the owner is clear that no trees will be cut between that house and the resource area.
At this point, it's I concur with the two opinions already stated. Any other discussion?
So I don't know if Terry mentioned that tree that's 35 feet away from the BBW, there is that tree. My recollection, there was one that was broken.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was coming down that was beyond that. I didn't go and look at that tree at all. So this tree here is still on their property. I might have drawn it further out, but maybe it's back a bit. But that was one that had tape on it by the driveway.
Yeah, I remember it being back further and a big
by the entrance. Yeah.
But I think the applicant just said she's not taking that tree.
If it fell down, I don't think it would fall on anything.
No,
we're talking about the one that's like out.
Yeah.
You couldn't even.
It's actually at the start of the fence. It's right there at the start of the fence.
Start of the wall? Mm-hmm.
Not the wall. There's a
the property line fence?
Yeah, what is that fence called? It's got like two rails and post and rail fence.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right, the fence.
Okay. It's right there at the very beginning of it.
Yeah.
Well, if it's not going to be touched, it's a kind of a non-issue.
If
it falls forward, it's going to fall towards the cul-de-sac, right?
I'm not sure, really. I don't know what... If it falls, I thought that it would just fall actually even behind the fence. Like it won't even fall on the fence.
Yeah, I would have to say that it would fall back towards the wetland. It's in that stone area. It's not going to get much bigger before it falls out of it.
Yeah.
Okay.
It may fall forward, but I think it's more likely to fall backwards.
Yeah, I don't think it's gonna. Yeah.
My concern with that tree, though, if it's the one that's partially broken or near the one that's partially broken. It'd be difficult to get in there. I don't know if they plan to come in with a crane or not. But
that one's in the center of the cul-de-sac, like at the very center, outside of, probably on their property, but right at the cul-de-sac.
Okay.
And you can see the branch, it's hanging down.
Oh, it's not,
we didn't
mark
that
not
one.
Back in the...
it is back in there,
it
too.
Is back. Yeah, it's about 30 feet back, maybe.
Yeah.
It's still not getting cut, though.
Yeah,
but there's no blue tape on that one. So that wasn't one that's on this plan.
Well, I think the one that's not on the plan that she wants cut is the one that just broke this weekend.
I think
that's in between the two of these.
Yeah,
it's a different
that
tree.
One was actually, that one wasn't.
It wasn't because it just happened.
It didn't have any blue tape because it just happened, yeah.
Just happened.
So there's one that's not on here.
And that should
then you want to take?
It has to go. It has to go.
Well,
it has to
it
be
has
on
to
here
it.
if she's going to take
it. It just happened this Sunday morning.
The limb broke off. I mean, it's on our yard.
We saw it.
Yeah.
Yeah,
but I mean, if you want to take that tree, we need to identify it on the
plan. I can draw it on the plan.
Okay, good.
Okay.
Draw it on that plan and I'll fit with the file.
Do you know what kind it was?
It was
a broken one.
It was a Norway.
I think it was a Norway.
Probably a Norway.
It was
a
Norway.
I looked at
it. It looked all the same.
Right near those saplings is probably a Norway maple sapling.
Now we're talking six trees still. but not the six orange trees.
Across this over.
Right, the six trees as modified on the plan by Mr. Sullivan.
Do you have your engineer stamp, Brian?
I'm not stamped. Plus or minus 5 feet.
So at this point, if these trees, it sounds like there's a consensus by the commission that we're going to agree to the cutting of these trees. Now, what about the 10 saplings? And so I want to take up the issue of what about the 10 saplings and what about replanting or invasive control in this area? Any thoughts on that?
Well, are these saplings all like 5 feet or less, or are they?
You're also had tape on them.
Oh, no, they're probably over 5 feet, but they're probably less than 2 inches. In
I mean, 5 feet off the wall.
Oh.
I think they're all, they're not 10, 15 feet out.
No, like, they're close. All close. They're close.
Yeah. They're
it's just to protect the stone wall.
Right.
From the
roots. I don't have a problem with the saplings going as well. With the offset of, well, what's going to happen in that void? You know, are we going to
Japanese
get some
already there.
Japanese knotweed's already there. If some attempt can be made to rein that in to foster the growth of some native mm-hmm. species, that would clearly mm-hmm. benefit the habitat.
I'm trying to work on my husband on that one.
Yeah. Whatever,
I agree with you 100%, but to try and control the growth of that knotweed is...
Well, maybe we can say...
If they want to do that, that's great, but I don't think we can make that a condition
right.
because chances of success are very, very low.
Well, I think we can encourage it. I think we can ask for some level of removal within the vicinity of any plant replanting we might request. To at least protect the root zone of what gets replaced in these areas.
But if by removal you mean digging up the roots, which is the only way you get rid of it, I'm not sure we want that kind of activity that close to the wetlands.
Well, I'm saying if that activity at a small scale by hand provides a way to establish a natural environment, a much more native environment, then that's a step forward, and you know, I want to encourage that anywhere in town, including my own yard, believe it or not. But.
Well, how about this as a compromise, that we ask for some plantings, and that they make sure those plantings survive, which will entail keeping the
Japanese
from
yeah.
their immediate vicinity.
Yeah.
That way we're not asking them to clear out all that knotweed, but make sure that what they plant survives
Give
and
them
is
a
chance. Not strangled by the knotweed.
That's pretty much what I'm saying.
Okay.
Is within the vicinity of those plantings.
So what are we going to ask them to plant?
Let's see. That's probably up for grabs. I would encourage bushes if you don't want trees
right.
in this area.
There's some in the shrub.
And I'm not sure herbaceous cover would grow
probably not.
Okay
pretty
in
shady.
This area. So some sort of shrub. What's the sense of the commission? One for one?
Mm-hmm.
And you talk about 10 saplings? And you talk about then?
Oh, I don't know if one for
one
the saplings for the trees.
Oh, yeah. One for
the trees
one.
And...
Oh, yes.
and
it's going to get a little crowded in there.
Right.
Well,
if
you're taking out
what,
all these saplings plus these two right here,
what
you're
makes sense?
Taking a big space out.
The saplings were just volunteer growth. I don't think that matters.
Okay.
2 years ago, they would have just stamped,
yeah.
just trampled that, and would have died off. But
yeah.
But something for the trees seems reasonable.
Right.
Okay. Well, why don't we say one native shrub?
Blueberry was suggested. Does
mm-hmm.
anybody
Whatever,
have any other suggestions besides blueberry?
Well, I think we have a list of natives
oh,
that
okay.
are
I can
that
send you
that
a
are.
List of,
so okay. you can pick and mm-hmm. talk to a landscaper about or. Somebody knowledgeable about what would thrive there,
okay.
shade tolerant and.
Blueberries work as long as you don't have a white car. Mm. They don't work so well.
Go ahead.
I just had a question. So if she does need to control or not, does she need to come back and clear with us how she's going to do it, or can she? Because it's really close to the well, and like, as you were talking about, like whether like the tarp cut and tarp will work there. I don't know. If, like,
I think
she needs to clear the method.
Well,
before
I think that's a good point. For management of that knotweed, and you know what I'm talking about, that bamboo
mm-hmm.
growth,
I think we would definitely like to be kept in the know as to your approach.
Mm-hmm. I was going to try what Allison suggested.
Cut and tarp.
I mean, we're just talking about a regular tarp, right?
Yeah, just something that'll block the sunlight from getting in. You just got to go and stop every once in a while.
And for how long? How does that?
I don't know
those
methods.
I've
never done
it
that
long.
But it's a long time.
Yeah.
But you just got to kill it, and then, I mean, it'll come back. But
the roots come out quite easily, too. You could try just pulling them up when they start to die down every year.
Or we have available for your use an instrument that's fun to use.
Say it right, Mr.
A weed winch.
Wrench.
Weed wrench.
Wrench. Wrench.
And
he does it every time.
You clamp it on the plant, and it's got a big handle for the lever, and it pulls it right out, and you're more than welcome to borrow.
Fantastic. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah.
Giving him
that out. Works on Japanese novels.
Yeah. It does.
So
really?
Yeah, because we went to Bear Meadows with that, and we took that plus the one the Trails Committee had, and we attacked the whole bottom part of
it.
Oh,
good.
We ripped out piles of it.
Well, what I do, but I email you to arrange coming to the
lab. Please do.
Okay.
That's good.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
it's fun to use.
I like it.
So is there any further discussion about this?
Just one other thing. That wall was repaired, and they did a good job, but if you have to do anything else with that wall, you need to come before this commission, because it's within the, it's close to the wetlands.
Yeah, we can remember that.
Yeah. Any other discussion? Any other questions? No? Questions by other people? No? Okay. I'll entertain.
Oh, wait, I do have a question.
Yeah,
sorry.
Go ahead.
When we're talking about taking down the trees that are being taken down and the saplings that are being taken down, so I was told, what, like 10 feet or something like that? We're not taking them all the way out, is that correct?
A stand. If you can leave a stand, that's helpful.
But how tall is a stand?
What, 6 feet?
6 feet's
six
fine.
To
4
feet?
To 6 feet, something.
4 to 6 feet, okay. That's true.
Just make sure you don't grind those stumps.
Yeah.
Stumps needs to stay.
Okay.
Less than the distance to your house.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, we went over that. There was actually a stand just out in the woods.
Yeah.
So I was able to identify that.
If you leave it 8 feet, there's a good chance that in a year or two or three, there'll be some beautiful woodpeckers that'll come in there, and you can watch them out of your window.
I don't need the woodpeckers in my area. They're doing just fine on my house.
Well, maybe they'll go to these trees
instead
to your house.
Yeah.
Instead. So, I mean, I know you had a squirrel issue before, and, you know.
Squirrels.
I know yours.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'll entertain a motion.
I move we issue a negative determination for 10 Johnson Circle.
Okay, it's motion and seconded. Any more discussion? All those in favor? Opposed?
Negative is good.
Negative is good. You want a negative, that means you don't have to refile under a different, more involved permit.
Great.
So, Chuck, you have this.
I do. I just wanted to ask, so we're asking for 6 new shrubs.
Native shrubs, yes.
And this 6 to 8 foot stand. And remove the saplings along the retaining wall. Is there anything else about the invasives that need to be removed, or that's just...
They need to be kept at bay so that the planted shrubs are able to survive or thrive.
The stipulation is the shrubs need to thrive, and
right.
You need to do what's necessary to help them thrive.
They need to stay out of the root zone of the new plantings, if you want to get specific.
Great.
So send that out tomorrow with the native plant list. And if you have any questions, just ask them the weed wrench.
You have to say it slowly.
I'm going to.
I'll start throwing things.
Great.
Okay. Thanks for coming in.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thanks for going through the whole process with us.
Oh, yeah.
A number of site visits and all. Yeah.
Great.
Okay, we'll sign this.
Work those for our women.
Have a good night. Thanks.
You too. All right. Okay. With a resident here, Chuck, I'm going to jumble the schedule a little bit. We have
Can I jump to the orders of conditions?
Yeah.
All right, then we're gonna, let's see, which one, why don't we do Green Street first?
Okay.
And is there anything, there's, I believe there's a resident here for Walnut, is there any? We're gonna take up that order of conditions tonight after this one.
So you wanna do Green Street first?
Yeah.
We already voted on that, right?
We have the order of conditions. We closed it. Now we're going to go through the order of conditions.
Oh, we didn't vote to issue an order of conditions.
We have.
I don't think we did, because.
We can check the minutes.
Yeah.
Oak Street.
So this has standard.
This is Green Street.
You can look through it, but there was a couple questions by Bill.
Only a close.
Bill Manuel.
We
closed the hearing, that's all.
We closed it, that's it.
How did you figure that out so quickly?
You go to the second page, then you go to the bold. Then you go to Green Street, motion made by Mr. Mon to close the public hearing.
And I wasn't even here.
Oh, okay, right, here you go.
So you had the wisdom to to close it.
Suggested last page.
All right, so we had some feedback from Mr. Manuel.
Yes. So I prepared an alternative last page.
Okay.
Which took into consideration the fact that there is lawn all the way up to the BBW at this property. So it would be unfair to reclaim that and request that it's turned back into an untouched zone, and that would be passed along to the successors of this property.
So Mr. Brenner is here.
Yes.
Do you have a copy of the order of conditions? Would you
I don't
like
know.
A copy?
Sure.
If you don't have an extra, thank you, Chuck.
Thanks.
Okay.
Tried my best to get Bill out here
today. Yeah, he seemed to at two meetings on his plate right now.
Yep. Okay. So the issues, Chuck, if you would just start with the issues Mr. Manuel had.
Number 14 in the special conditions, he said that the distilling basin, he would prefer that that was...
What page are you on?
17.
He would prefer that that would be something we would determine on site, since the entire lot is within the 100-foot buffer zone. This seemed reasonable.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So I would change that to reflect his hopes.
Okay.
That's number 14. And then the last page, I passed out a supplement. We have our standard language on page 19, which asks for granite bounds and the to preserve and maintain in perpetuity in an unobstructed manner. And that was the language that we had, that Bill had an issue with, and we came up with an alternative to that. Now again, this lot has lawn and has historically had lawn right up to the BBW, right up to the flagged area. And if we left this language in A1 alone, then it would have to be returned back into its natural condition, which is unacceptable because not only is it a small lawn, but it would reduce the value of the house and if it was ever to be sold.
Yeah, I'm actually in agreement that, you know, the existing lawn is a sort of a grandfathered pre-existing condition. And, you know, setting the bounds at, setting a restriction to cease mowing in something that's pre-existing kind of doesn't make sense with what our precedent has been throughout the town. So I don't take issue with.
Can we change the language so that the bounds are set not at 25 feet, but at the edge of the existing lawn, so we don't lose any more?
We could, what I thought, I mean, I so I wrote, do you have that supplemental page?
I do. I haven't read it yet, but I have it.
So what I underlined is the change that I made to take out that that area between the flags and the 25-foot. I didn't know what to do about the bounds, because it seemed to me that bounds set in the ground at the height of grass is not going to bother anybody. So I wanted to leave you guys with that, because those bounds are still going to let everyone know that at the 25-foot, this is a zone of natural vegetation, but it has been grandfathered in. So maybe we, and me and Bill talked about this, instead of being at you know, whatever the 40-foot intervals and at the corners, one at flag 3 and one at flag 9.
At
no, did I say flag 3? No, at the 25-foot line at flag 3 and at flag 9.
But that, I guess I'm really confused. That, then you're putting the bounds in manicured lawn.
Right.
The property limit.
Grandfathered in.
But those bounds don't mean, go ahead.
Typically mean you cannot do any cutting, any landscaping between the bounds and the resource area.
I understand. When I go out to properties and see that, I always say you're not supposed to be working in back of this.
Right.
But we don't ever put them on the flags. You know, we don't ever put them on the edge of the BBW either.
Maybe we
should. So there's no reason that we couldn't. But that's something that we're going to establish right here tonight.
If we know that every other property in town has bounds at 25 foot, and we go to this property and we see, oh, these got to be the 25 foot line.
It's still confusing. Yeah.
Unless those bounds are explicitly stating wetlands.
Right.
We have conservation area, we have restricted area, and I forgot what the other one said. Maybe you guys know. But there's three signs in the office that work.
Well, let me tell you my thought in putting them at or near the flags. If in the future that wetland receded and the wetland line moved down gradient 10 feet, we would want to protect that 10 feet. No longer wetland.
That makes sense, yeah.
But it's already natural vegetation.
That makes sense.
That way you don't lose any yard, but future generations don't infringe any more on the zone of natural vegetation than has already happened.
Would you just repeat that? Because I kind of missed that.
Okay. Let's say, which happens, it's not that unusual, 10 years from now, that wetland line is moved down Grady.
Moved
north. And so then you have, let's say moved 10 feet. You have an area of 10 feet, which is now wetland, but if the wetland line moves, it wouldn't be wetland anymore. But if we put the bounds where the wetland flags are,
you retain the original boundary.
We would retain the natural vegetation between the current line and the future line.
Makes sense.
That's if it. I agree with what you're saying. I think to this extent, something put at the boundary between that grandfathered lawn and what we're calling a natural area, untouchable, is a very useful part of establishing a bound. The challenge I see is if all our bounds have always meant 25 feet, then we're going to get really confused coming back to this property about what those bounds mean. And I think we have gone to properties and looked at bounds and gone, we don't know what these bounds mean. This is upland. So, and setting that restriction to explaining that to you, the property owner, that, you know, this is a sort of a limited use space, you know, that can't be dumped in and has
right.
to be protected as a natural space. I think you already know that. Mm-hmm. But to, you know, the successive property owners, those bounds get kind of permanent?
Yeah.
I think this
is all new to me, and I think I understood from the beginning of this process the, you know, the 25 feet from the edge of the wetlands is, even though it's been my yard, it's been there since I moved in.
Yeah.
For instance, I couldn't put a pool there or some kind of structure
right.
inside
right.
that 25 feet.
Right.
What caught me off guard was now with this proposed deed restriction type thing that maybe this can't even be my yard anymore or a future owner's yard.
Well,
as originally drafted, that is true.
That was the original language. Our precedent so far has been to allow existing yards to remain but also to protect as much as possible the natural resource
sure.
that has been discovered
yeah.
on your property. So, you know, talking about these bounds, it's a little bit of a puzzle because it's an unusual situation because you have existing lawn.
Right.
Okay? So we would usually put those bounds, as Mr. Mon said, at that 25 foot line along 40 foot intervals. And now you already have a lawn and we want to respect that. And so where do we put those bounds?
Right.
We can't put them along that 25 foot.
Right.
So where's a good place to put them in perpetuity?
I seem to remember a case where we put the bounds at the edge of an existing driveway, even though it was less than 10 feet.
And what did that bound represent?
No clearing.
No clearing.
I can't cite the address, but I seem that seems because it didn't make. We couldn't put a bound in the middle of the driveway. That made no sense at all.
So, if I think the decision has to be whether to put it on the BBW or not put any at all.
I agree with that.
Because
if you're
not supposed to disturb, then
yeah.
anytime that, you know, if you wanted to do something else on the property and we went there, or our future successors went there, hey, how come this is not natural vegetation? And
yeah.
then there'd have to be an explanation, and here's my deed, and this is what it says.
Well,
and,
to some degree,
well,
though.
Yeah, I don't agree, because I think that if you're the bounds are there to alert people that there's something going on. And, you know, how many times is a permit just, we don't have a permit, we have weekend warriors, and there's, you know, there's a shed out there, there's something else. But if they see these bounds in the ground, they're going to have to ask about it. They're going to, you know, they're going to come up and say, hey, what does this mean that it says conservation restriction or conservation land? But the explanation's right here. It's written in. If you accept that supplement, they would only have to defer to that. And it actually tells them what you can do. And the two bounds on the 25-foot line would be consistent, and the paperwork explains it, rather than putting them at the you know, on the flags or on the BBW edge, which we have no paperwork that explains that. We'd have to modify this, which
Done. It would have to be stated in here.
Yeah, it would have to be explained.
Can
we take a minute and read this and see?
Sure. So I just thought two at the very edge, just like you were, you know, just try to get out of everyone's way at the two corners of the property on the 25-foot line at grass level serves the purpose.
Is that pretty straight?
It's not.
No.
Well, here, I'll show you the plan.
But it is at two points.
But also, I guess my question to you, sir, is... the functional use of your backyard, if those bounds are put at the 25-foot line,
mm-hmm.
You know, that would give you, you know, these lines are only drawn on the plan. That would give you, in real space, a better understanding of your lawn for future
mm-hmm.
planning purposes.
Right, so I can't put a shed or...
Yeah, and so
something.
then you would know, you know, at a minimum, well, hey, you know, and maybe having them at that 25-foot line at the property edge.
That's right, and fertilizer
would,
and all
would,
that beyond
could
that
tell
point.
You,
so
you
I
know,
would,
could give you a
Terry
sense.
But as points out, it's not a straight line.
It's not, but that's a maximum distance. That's
actually
a closest
not,
to the house.
No, it's not.
It is on both, if you drew a straight line from one side to the other. It's a maximum.
You can certainly put one in the center and make it more realistic, but if you only wanted to put two in, there is a little bit of
I mean, you would cut this loss out, but
not that it would be an actual loss, but if someone drew a line straight across.
Losing a bit, let's move this up 4 inches. You wouldn't have to, you'd have a straight line as long as it averaged out, wouldn't you?
Put three in.
But
then he's got a marker in the middle of his lawn.
Oh, it could be sunk in a little bit. It could be sunk in a little bit. So
the grass is kind of cut. Well,
doesn't cut.
You could only put it on the 25-foot line at number 3 and number 9. And if you wanted to mark out where it drops down in between, then you could put one in the center. If not, then you just have to know that. I mean, you can just keep the plans.
Yeah, I mean, we're not doing anything back there. I'm a little confused about the original, the request for the deed restriction with the 25-foot barriers or whatever, versus what we're talking about now, which is just marking it, but we're still able to maintain it as we've done, as a yard at least, versus another scenario where we can't even go back there anymore.
You're asking why are we... allowing you to keep your lawn?
No. Oh. I think that's great. I guess what I was confused about is the language as written is sort of leaning towards taking away that lawn, and we're trying to modify that.
Okay. Did you see the modified
on the
language?
Original? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah,
yes, the original.
Well, most properties that come to us have wooded area back there. Mm. They have much more than 25 feet of just wooded area, and there's only been a few since I've been here that don't. That
it
don't
goes
have
right
like,
to the
yeah that yeah. has grass right down to where the water is or where the wetland is, so it works in a lot of situations. In other words,
okay.
Yes.
So is the substitute language A1 or A2?
A1.
A1. Underline.
The underline part.
Well, it doesn't make sense to me. I mean, there's a. Owners and successors have a right to maintain the property in its historic condition, but no structure will be allowed within the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation and the 10-foot no structure zone, period. And the stone or concrete bounds marking the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation. I don't understand
so
that.
So we have to cross, we have
and
to edit
cross
this.
Out.
Cross out the and capital T.
The stone or concrete bounds marking the 20-foot zone of natural vegetation, all is required under the order of conditions recorded with the Middlesex Seth Canary Register. That's not a complete sentence.
Yeah, we got to modify that sentence.
Why is it okay the way it is?
Because
it's a run-on.
The sentence, yeah. It's not, it's the grammatically incorrect.
They have a right to maintain the property and a right to the
But are I mean, if, as written, are we requiring stone or concrete bounds? And if so, where? Doesn't say.
Well,
we say we're requiring them at the 25-foot zone.
Well, that's what we're hashing out. The stone or concrete bounds will, shall, that's the language, right?
Shall
mark the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation.
But I thought we weren't asking him to mark the 25-foot zone.
Well, it was
well, we're discussing it. So I think I see some sense in sort of establishing those markers at the property line, where the property line approximately meets that 25-foot zone, but. Maybe additionally for you, setting up something so that you know where that wetland flag line is.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think you had some sense of it because your lawn stopped there and
pretty much. Yeah.
And I don't know if more could be done to establish that as a no disturb line for you.
Maybe like a fence. Or is that
something I don't know. I'm just entertaining that thought if we can kind of codify, like permanently establish that 25-foot zone with boundary markers at the property line and set something up at the wetland line. And I don't have a preconceived idea of what that something is.
That property where he's going to put in two or three homes down by Greenwood Acres, you know that...
92 Sanborn?
No, on the way to REI off Salem Street on your right back in there in that condo development.
Yep.
Okay, we had them put markers at 35 feet because it didn't make sense to put them at 25 feet. I remember that. Just because of the layout of the house. I'm opposed to putting markers 25 feet from the wetland line where there's existing yard between that marker and the wetland. Because it's saying this is a zone of natural vegetation, yet there's manicured lawn. Future owners, their neighbors, it would be, they wouldn't pull the file to look at the language. It would just be very confusing. I would support putting markers, and we can talk about the language, at the exact location of flag A9, A6, and A3. And saying no disturbance within those, that allows him to have his yard. In perpetuity, there won't be any disturbance in the wetlands or if the wetlands recede in what's now natural vegetation.
So if I remember that map, 3 and 9 are on either edge of the property.
Either edge, right. And 6 is in the middle.
Take a look.
In the middle.
Yeah.
6 jogs right
here,
and I see.
Yeah.
If you put it at A9 and then at A5, if somebody were to draw a line, they'd cut off a piece of wetland between those two. It almost becomes like a turning point.
He wanted that. He didn't say it would be.
I like the idea of putting something concrete at the limit of what should be disturbed and what is allowed, permitted to be touched and not permitted to be touched.
I like that too.
If you mark it at A6, he has more property to use the way he wants to. If you mark it at 5 or 8,
right,
and it cuts off.
It's already lawn there.
It's already lawn anyway. Okay.
But I mean, I could go with A6 and A3 and A9, but
that cuts out.
That's cutting right out.
But those.
So we have language that's going to go on. When I was thinking about this, where I was at was how do we keep it the most consistent as it has been in town for someone else? And it seemed to me that we modified everything, but so that's where I was asking. But I don't really, as long as the commission's okay with it, I think it's going to confuse half the people no matter what.
Right,
well,
I agree with that.
But at the same time, when we walk in, yes, it's absolutely going to confuse us as to what those markers mean, because we traditionally think of them as that 25-foot. But at the same time, it's still demarking mowable, don't disturb, which is what those markers have meant. It's, even though it's a different limit line, it's got the same meaning if we put it at the wetland flags. So I understand the confusion, but in this case, we're making the judgment of we're permitting him to do that building. Maybe we could have something put on those markers that say wetland line.
This is put here to confusion.
Yeah.
Or the grandfather line.
Go ahead.
I'm sort of leaning, just for what it's worth, that I like this idea better, but... I see where these markers to me or to somebody that's maybe coming to look at my property, if they're 25 feet in,
yeah,
would automatically think, what's the problem?
What's happening?
Do anything in this other? And they're going to have to go do the homework to find out what was written versus if the exception's made to allow it at the edge of the wetlands.
It's clear.
The commission knows already.
Yeah.
And then somebody coming to look to maybe buy my property, or, okay, that makes sense, I see this, the swamp starts here and we can't.
Right.
But you know through experience that even though there might be bounds at that wetland line, closer to the house are other imaginary lines, invisible lines, that there's restricted space
in
that lawn.
The 25 feet.
You know,
yeah,
and that's where things get kind of crazy when there's a change of property.
Right.
That's been a frequent challenge
right.
to us.
But they, yeah, so it would have to be explained to them that that's the edge, but you can't build within
and
35 feet.
And certain people will explain that openly and clearly, and certain people won't. That doesn't happen, whether they intend to or not. I can't make that decision. But So I could be in favor of setting those bounds, one at A3, one at A9, because those are the closest flags to the house. And if, I mean, otherwise we're going to kind of need one at A3, one at A5, one at A6, one at A8, one at A9.
Well, I can see three, six, and nine, like Jamie said. That's pretty much kind of half and half. I mean, you're losing a little bit. But not as much as
yeah, three, six, and nine though cuts off wetlands. If somebody were to draw a straight line from three, six, and nine, you're cutting it there and here. So it would be here, 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 there. I mean, we could skip four.
3, 5, 7, and 9. Yeah.
But I would see that as almost as confusing. So right. I'd be tempted to go with just A3 and A9, or A3, A5, A6, A8, A9. I mean, either you really approximate it, and I don't know. Yeah, do you want to see
it? I can see. I just think that if you do the A3, A9, where the house is right now, I don't really see, like, because how much distance is between A3, A9, straight across line, and the sunken in part? Because, like, really, what are they going to be able to put in that little triangle?
There's a 20-foot scale.
So it's big. Okay, that's why I was curious. Okay.
It doesn't, based on the lines drawn on the plan, it almost doesn't look like 20 feet when it gets closer to the house. It's more like 15, but... Yes, go ahead.
I'm just reading a note from Bill. I would suggest adding monuments at flags A3 and A9, and then modifying the language of the deed restriction to say no disturbance of wetlands beyond those bounds. But we're still going to have no disturbance, like you said, not just beyond those bounds, but 25 feet back into the
right.
yard. That's still a restriction. It's
absolutely.
Just,
right,
it's just where we're marking it as the...
Right.
Is the question.
You know, we're allowing mowing, which we don't typically
right.
do in that 25. That's
right.
a pretty rare exception in town. There's plenty of people who do want to mow that 25-foot zone.
But
you have pre-existing lawns, so.
I could support any combination of bounds as long as A3 and A9 are included.
Okay. Well, then, is there any objection to just keeping a bound at A3 and one at A9? As long as those bounds are clearly labeled... wetlands.
Essentially,
wetlands
that
line.
Far back, how high above the ground would you like that?
Oh, 40 feet.
So it's supposed to be 2 feet in and what, 6 feet, 6 inches up? Is that the standard?
So 6 inches?
I'd be happy with something a little bit taller, but I don't know what our standard has been.
I've never seen one more than 6 feet.
Oh, really?
Policy for
go to 1185 Main Street.
Ironically, there's been a metal stake in one corner of my yard since I bought the house, and I don't know
on
if
West
that
Street?
Was previously
is
had
it,
something to do with the wetlands or not.
Near the street or,
no,
or
in
the back?
Main
in
Street.
My backyard
Street
corner.
Too.
Oh, yeah, 4 feet above. Yeah.
That might be somebody's...
It's a metal tube type of thing, about, I don't know, 3 feet.
Okay.
Let's say at least
a foot. How's at least a foot stand?
I don't think I've seen any a foot except those at Market Basket, which are light poles. So.
I've seen those. I think a foot
neatly trimmed around them.
I think a foot is easy to visually spot. Hopefully, you know, if you don't like how it looks, you could plant something in front of it to block it.
It won't get buried that way.
Won't get buried.
What are we, talking about, a like a post?
A concrete.
Yeah.
A concrete post. You can go with granite if you want to.
A 4x4 post made out of concrete.
Yeah.
4x4.
That's what
four inch.
Yeah, 4 inch.
Four inch by 4 inch. Yeah. Yeah. So.
The ones in Market Basket are about 2 feet by 2 feet.
Ah,
they're
that big.
They're pretty big.
2 feet by 2 feet. I'm going to go check those. Well,
yeah,
we're not asking for something that big in this case. So I think...
2 feet down, 1 foot up. 3 foot.
Yeah. So it sounds like we've got an agreement as to the flags. Any other objections?
So there'd be no deed restriction of maintaining, as is, at least the lawn and with this. This is just basically marking.
The deed restriction... The deed restriction does happen,
right? It
because
does.
That's part of the
what's it gonna say?
Notice of intent. So, the stone or concrete bounds shall mark the 25-foot of zone of natural vegetation.
But they won't.
At flags.
No, they won't mark the 25-foot.
Will mark the wetland boundary.
Oh, that's a new sentence right there, okay.
Marking
the stone or concrete bounds, marking the edge of the BVW.
No, not BVW, so it's wetlands.
Right.
So it's...
It is BVW, though.
Okay, thanks. Yep, I'm getting my acronyms mixed up.
So you could say the edge of the BVW.
Yep.
But we should spell that, we shouldn't use the letters.
I did that for you guys.
Okay. Marking the edge of the wetlands... at flags A3 and A9.
On the plans dated?
Well, they're referred to in the findings, right?
Yeah, I couldn't find those. Are they? I'm not saying they're not.
The findings?
Well, we can go back to that.
Yeah.
Care.
At a minimum, 1 foot, at least 1 foot high. And they should be labeled as BVW. Somehow.
And will there also be language in this deed restriction about it's okay to maintain the lawn that's infringes on the 25 feet? Or is that?
Well, I think it's in there already.
Owners and successors have a right to maintain the property in its historic condition.
So that's
so
okay.
We're leaving that in.
Okay.
We're
leaving that in.
Okay.
Okay, is that language clear? Should we, any questions on that?
So the underlying stuff is okay, and then at no structure zone period, the stone or concrete bounds marking the edge of the BVW spelled out at flags 3A and 3, A3 and A9 on the plans dated, whatever they are, at a minimum of 2 foot in the ground, 1 foot above the ground, marking
the edge of wetlands.
Marking the edge of wetlands. We must have something.
Yeah.
I hate to be picky, but let's say this has the current owner strikes a bridge and moves to Brazil and doesn't sell his property, but lets it stand abandoned for years. And that yard grows up into natural vegetation. If we leave that phrase in there, owners and successors have right to maintain the property in its historic condition, that means they could go down and cut that native vegetation right up to the boring vegetation.
No, they can't because the historic condition is now overgrown.
Well, what's historic? It's at any time in the past, right?
Well, then...
because if you didn't do anything for 3 years, would that be long enough?
So you would.
Exactly.
So if someone bought this after it was overgrown and they went back and researched this and found out that you could, with this document, mow up to the... I would say that that's its historic condition. Lawn up to the BVW.
So instead of maintain the property in its historic condition, are you suggesting we get more specific?
I think that's clear, because it just means they have that right to, and if they neglect it for a couple of years, it just means you can't go back and clean it out again.
How about instead of...
Well, that's what I'm asking, is does it mean that?
Yeah, it seems to imply that.
How about instead of...
They have right to maintain the historic condition. It doesn't say they always have to do it, but they have the right to it.
How about it, instead of historic, we say in its existing condition? Because that sort of sets...
Well, existing is what's currently there, so maybe...
You'd have to have a bridge
and some fill inside the wetland, so...
No, but that's what's there at the time of this permit, reference
to
this plan.
Where it shows existing lawn. As shown on the plan, you could say.
All right. We're not looking at the plan for this. All these other scenarios. No one was referring to the plan.
Yeah, we did. We said it.
No, not as we were writing. We were writing it as if no one would look.
Oh.
Let me ask this question. Let's say we had a property and a neighbor called and said somebody's out there cutting 5 feet from the wetland. And we went out there and said, oh, wow, they cut down all these trees. And he said, well, this was lawn 10 years ago, 15 years ago, and I just returned to lawn. Would that be okay with us?
We'll tackle that 10, 15 years from now.
Yeah.
How about that?
I mean, it's a historic condition. It's probably an apple field, an apple orchard or something like that, you know? Even beyond that, maybe...
Yeah, the history's always changing.
Woods. I don't know. It gets to a point where
it's almost impossible to write
ridiculous.
Something accurate.
I do like the existing condition better than historic.
I mean, it conveys the same idea, and it kind of codifies it in the reference of today's plan and the current practices. When it says on the plan, it says existing lawn,
right,
with arrows pointing on it. So why don't, if there's no objections, why don't we change the word historic to existing?
Because it was historic up to this point, now it's existing, so we're freezing it at a point in time.
Right.
Right.
That's where it is right now. I like that word. So.
Okay. So, any other discussion on this particular topic?
Well, paragraph A2 now either has to be deleted or changed or something.
Yeah, because they're talking about
it's deleted.
Two foot.
It's deleted.
It's deleted.
Okay.
We have a goal tonight.
Okay. Do you have any objections or questions or comments?
I think this sounds positive.
Okay.
To the best of my knowledge.
If you can tell us what we said, we'd appreciate it. Chuck, could you read back A1?
Sure. The owner and the successor have the right to maintain the property in its historic condition. Or do you want to start from the quit claim deed?
Start at just the beginning of A1, if you don't mind.
Sure. The lot is and shall remain subject to the following perpetual deed restriction: quitclaim deed, grantor identification information, granted to grantees information, land with the building herein subject to the following deed restriction. Owner and successor have the right to maintain the property in its existing condition, but no structures will be allowed within the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation and the 10-foot no structure zone. The stone concrete bounds marking the edge of the BBW at flag A3 and A9 on the plans dated whatever they are at a minimum of 2 foot in depth and 1 foot above the ground at the edge of the wetland, all as required under the order of conditions recorded with the Middlesex South District Registry of Deeds. This restriction shall survive the issuance of any certificate of compliance, the deed of conveyance from the grantor to the grantee of the lot shall contain restrictions and shall be expressed in conveyance, and all the deeds and all this restrictions shall forthwith be subject by the grantor of the Reading Conservation Commission.
Hey, Dick, if you just read that sentence again that begins the stone or concrete bounds.
Sure.
I think it's not a complete sentence, it's just.
I think.
We need a verb in there.
Just say shall mark.
The stone or concrete bounds.
Shall mark.
Shall mark.
Marking.
Shall mark.
The stone or concrete bounds shall mark the edge of BVW at flag A3 and A9. Does that sound better?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Don't we want to say the, do we want to say that the stone or concrete bounds have to be installed?
That's what we probably should say. The stone or concrete bounds shall be installed to mark.
Yeah, there you go.
To mark. Shall there be installed to mark.
I'll hand it to you. The stone or concrete bounds shall be installed to mark the edge of BVW at flags A3 and A9. As required under this order of conditions.
Right. Shall be installed to mark the edge of BVW at, I don't think you said to mark.
To mark. That's what you said, right?
As shall be installed to mark the edge of BVW at flags A3 and A9 as required.
So we don't need that all?
No, as required under this
order
of conditions and recorded with the Middlesex South District Registry of Deeds. Okay? How's that sound? I got a rhythm. Okay, those are the edits. Are there any other comments or questions about this order of conditions?
A question, where in the order do we reference the plans in the NOI?
Should be the findings. So page
should be under
14.
Documents, the very first page on 14.
Yep.
Page 14?
Yep.
Yep, item 2, site plan entitled Proposed Plot Plan.
Page 14. Hold on.
And there it is, dated July with the right date, signed by Vernon LeBlanc. Yep. Yep, that reference is right. Okay. Can you hand that to Chuck just in case? Yep, so that plan reference is right.
The following documents are hereby incorporated into this order. To the extent that the provisions and conditions in this order are different from those in these documents, this order shall control.
Right.
Notice of intent.
Okay.
To be picky, where do we say that activity has to be in conformance with that notice of intent in the site plan?
In the site plan?
And the site plan. Where do we say that the actions by the applicant have to be in conformance with that site plan?
Where's the final tie-in?
I mean, we have a bunch of documents, site visits, USGS map, site report, Aquifer Protection District. But where do we actually say that what the applicant does has to be in conformance with those plans?
How about item 8? This order applies to all areas in the 100-foot buffer zone where that adds storm drainage to a discharge point in said resource area.
Are you back on page?
Page 15.
Yeah, but what is that? That didn't have anything to do with the plan.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does, because the reference of this order, the document supporting this order, well, it's sentence one, the following documents are hereby incorporated into this order.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So it's also, go ahead.
On 5 of 12, it says in the first thing, failure to comply with all conditions stated herein, and with all related statutes and other regulatory measures shall be deemed cause to revoke or modify this order. So they have to do it as part of the Massachusetts Wetland Protection Act.
And under A, number 8, you are referencing the plans, and it says see attached.
Where are you, Chuck?
I'm on the Wetlands Protection form, the first page 2.
Page two.
Of 12.
Uh-huh.
And it's A8.
Final approved plans and other documents, see attached.
Okay, good, that's what I like, but they aren't attached.
They are, that's the
order
of conditions, that's the findings.
But the plans aren't attached.
The documents, do you attach the site plan too?
That doesn't get recorded, the plans, but it's referenced in, the supplement to this order of conditions is what we've always done, what I've always seen done.
I know what he's talking about. When you write specifications for a job, you have to reference the plans. You have to say, all work must conform to the lines and grades as shown on the plans,
oh, yeah,
titled blah, 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 blah.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he's looking for.
That's what I'm looking for. And I would like the plans attached to this order.
So we can have them...
all the documents attached?
Not all the documents, but the plans.
And sent to the DEP?
DEP, the applicant, have it in
their
file.
Is that standard practice for
notices? So to say that the following documents are hereby incorporated into this order and then to note the plans and its revisions, that's not tying these two pieces together and pointing everyone to the plans and the revisions?
It might be or it might not, but if we add language that Brian, something along the lines of what Brian just suggested.
Where would that go? Would that go where I said see attached? Or would that go under the documents or part of the findings?
I guess
I'm a little confused about this because...
Well,
this sounds like a pretty big procedural attachment that, you know, why is this coming up now with this particular order?
Are you going to record
well,
the plans?
I got it.
Where?
Number 13 on page 6 of 12, the work shall conform to the plans and special conditions referenced in this order.
There.
Done.
Page 6.
Okay.
Thank you, DP.
Good.
Good.
We knew we had it somewhere.
Yeah. I still would like the plans attached, so it's all in one package.
And further, it goes to say any changes to those plans shall require the applicant to inquire of the Conservation Commission in writing.
But we don't. But that means we have to make copies of the plan and send them out to DEP.
Whoa.
DEP has a copy.
Oh, they already have a copy. Then they already have it.
They have the whole package.
Okay, so we don't have to provide plans.
Are we having the plans recorded? Is that what you were getting at, or you wanted it attached? What does that mean?
I would just feel better if they were attached.
But what does that do?
That way you have it all in one package, and if down the road there's a question of what happened, think of this. Think how many certificates of compliance we've had, and we've gone out in the field and said, well, what were they supposed to do? We don't know. If it had been attached to the order of conditions, we could tell.
I don't know. I just think that's how I get.
We're talking one sheet of paper.
For our file
We're talking
copy?
One sheet?
Yeah. That's not always the case.
No, it's not always the case at all.
Everything's kept in a file. We are putting everything in laissez-faire. There is no way that this doesn't tell me which final plan is the one that we approved. It's written right there with its dates and revisions and has the engineer stamped on it with his name and number. You can't be mistaken. I mean, this
right.
been doing this.
Right, I think
this
what you're
is,
talking about.
I wouldn't be confused by this.
I think what you're talking about is the day in, day out file management that we like to see when we go out for the certificate of compliance. You know, not only did this order... What were all the terms of this order met, but what's the plan that references it? Because usually we're working off a plan. That's our main document.
Well, you should have a plan that's the final revised plan.
We can do that.
I don't see the disconnect.
We
must be talking
about
two different things because I don't see how you couldn't find that plan. It's referenced right here.
Yeah.
It's going to be in the file. And with the laissez-faire, you're going to be able to
We've had orders of certificates of compliance where we couldn't find the plans, believe me.
Well, that's just being Oh, so this is more of a function of keeping better records together.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we're destroying all our records here in town. This is all everything goes on laserfiche once it's closed out. So you'll be presented in the future with 11.5 by 17 copy of the as-built.
I'd like to move this to a vote if there's no objection. Is there a motion?
I will move we approve the order of conditions as amended for DEP Mass DEP 270-0631.
Okay, is there a second?
Yeah, I'll second it.
Okay, all those in favor of approving the order as amended tonight? Okay. It's approved.
Thank you.
And so the schedule now for it is it gets modified, the final wording gets codified, and are we signing that tonight, Chuck?
It's ready to be signed.
Okay, so we'll sign it tonight, and at that point, it's ready. There's a waiting period for notices of intent. There's like an appeal period officially.
It's 10 days.
10 days. So if there's any public group that wants to appeal your notice of intent for some reason, they have that right to do so. So I can't officially say go ahead within that 10-day waiting period.
We're quite a ways from.
Okay. When are you thinking?
Probably not until the spring.
Okay.
Honestly, yeah. So
all right.
And the Stilling Basin thing, that was kind of a non-issue.
That Stilling Basin, I think we agreed to.
I'm going
to
modify that.
Modifying that.
They
so.
Agreed to just doing it on site.
Okay.
So I think when I talked to Bill about basically all got approved.
Okay.
The way he originally stated. So he'll be happy.
And we can keep arguing.
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you, Mr. Brenner.
Thank you. Very educational.
Have a good evening.
I can't say I retained most of it, but
well, you can always go onto RCTV and watch it.
Streaming.
Okay. Yeah.
For the next week, if you want.
Thanks.
Right. Have a good
nice night.
All right. Why don't we take up the order of conditions for 152, 156 Walnut Street? While we're at it, while we're whizzing through these orders of conditions, let's.
That's a classroom department, I thought.
Chuck, you know you don't have all those edits on this.
No, I have another piece of paper over here. Is that Anika's? No, I have mine.
Partially.
Oh, that's well. This is the text.
I have mine right here.
Yeah.
Just to get some of these here.
Around.
Yeah. This is the text,
so
but I put that here
up to here.
Tell you what, I steal this. Sorry.
Oh, that's a little fuel on the fire.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
Why can't you edit that stuff right as we're telling you, right on your computer?
Sure.
No. I mean, I'm serious. I mean, if you have the file open,
recorded.
Is that not allowed? Or?
Did I get you twice?
Yeah. No, just once. Or twice thought about it.
Oh, you mean can Kim record it?
No. I mean,
or Chuck.
I mean, Chuck.
Right now.
I mean, if he entered it into the system right as we're doing it, maybe he can't do that. I don't know.
I don't know.
It might be able to.
Hard to be part of it. I mean, we could, but it's hard to be part of the conversation and actually.
Right.
You know, maybe you want me to talk less. I don't know. Maybe that's the.
That's
no,
not what I'm getting.
No, we're like your input.
No,
I'm just thinking
if it would be more efficient, so you didn't have to have the notes and then bring the notes and consolidate the notes and.
My style has been consistently just write them out. Okay, if I'm having a hard time and it's too long, I'll ask someone else to do it. But to type them up with all the changes is going to be the hardest thing for me.
Oh, okay. Because I know I can type a heck of a lot faster than I can write. So.
That's the previous one.
And here's my edits. I don't know if you want yours.
I'll just send them out.
Well, no, that's the other property that you have in your left hand.
Okay.
So I need those. So which sheet is it?
This is DPW. This is the, what, for the previous order of conditions that we just voted and signed?
No, for Green Street.
That's Green Street.
Okay. This one, not this one.
I think so. I think so.
I used to sketch things out.
Are you not prepared to move on to the next?
Well, I just want to read this.
Okay.
So we can have a break.
Okay, let's take a 5-minute recess. Okay?
He said the height, but not the dimensions.
There's actually so many feet in, too, because A2 talked about being 2 feet in. Within a quarter, maybe 6 feet under.
Somebody said 2 feet below ground, 1 foot above ground.
He said that on the frost.
A2 said
160 sheets.
What? A2.
They're 4 feet high, you can at least see them from the road.
What's that?
So when you drive past 1189 Main Street, you know, no matter how fast you're going, that developer put them in 4 feet high, and you can just drive past and notice if anything's in back of them.
It's Reddinghenge instead of Stonehenge. Down on West Street, there's a house down there that they did. We went in the backyard, and they had these big, tall granite posts sticking right out of them.
I don't.
What is this?
That big.
Is that what we want? So bring
that's what we've done standard. That's been, it's been
everything I've seen has been about that size.
Yeah.
Survey markers is 6x6.
I think that's a bit much. But so I'd like to move on when you're ready. Call this session back in order.
Square.
Sounds great. Can I pass it over to
well, I have the whole thing right here.
But this is DPW engineering for Walnut Street. This is Green Street.
This is Green Street.
Oh, well then. Well then, sign on. Because I think we're going to move on without you.
He'll catch up.
Okay, then let's call this back to session, and let's take up the matter of 156 Walnut Street. I see there's a resident here who's come to these hearings before. Just for the sake of the record, do you mind repeating your name and address?
Grace Fitzpatrick, 162 Walnut Street.
Okay, thank you. Grace. And did you sign in, Ms. Fitzpatrick? Did you sign in?
Yes.
Did you sign in?
Oh,
okay.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so Chuck, this order of conditions, were there any comments or questions from the DPW or engineering division?
No. Nope.
There were none?
Okay.
Okay. Just gonna go through it. Let's go through this a little bit. Do you want to talk us through this a little bit, Chuck? Or there were a couple of plan revisions. We got at least. There was an initial, and then based on Mr. Mon's comments, the pipe inlet was moved to the east to allow for a 2-foot wide swale.
So I don't know. Wait.
Oh, go ahead. Go ahead with the order of conditions. Is there anything in particular you wanted to point out?
It's pretty standard. I referenced, again, this is just some background on the property. I referenced the plans, and it's boilerplate. It's boilerplate notice of intent or order of conditions.
Okay.
So what you just said is not in there. I didn't reference that. That move was made.
That a change was made from the original plan.
Yeah.
But you did reference the plan that it's.
Yes, I did. It's the plan is referenced and the revisions are referenced.
Yep.
Where are they referenced?
In the documents.
They're not.
Number four is plan revisions.
They're not in the documents.
I have the June 2.
But I'm talking about here.
Plan revisions. Plan revisions, but it says August.
August 13th.
I documents say, item number 4.
This says July 28th.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, it's July.
Something. Here's okay, so August 13 is the date. We should probably change that plan revisions.
This July 28th plan revision does have the open channel for the first 60 or so feet.
Is there another plan?
There was an earlier plan.
This earlier plan.
But there's no additional plan after that.
No, this is the latest. Okay, notice of work.
town. Drainage improvements. The Wetland Preservation Incorporated document, that has the planting plan. We'll throw that, we'll add that into the documents.
Okay, so.
That is dated August 13th. Or if you want to add that to number four, I don't know if you can, documents, maybe item four could be Walnut Street Drainage.
Planning plan.
Okay, plan revisions. Because you know what I think happened, Chuck, is when he, you referenced this in item four.
Yeah.
But they didn't put the date of the revised plan as August 13th. The revised plan's date is, the actual drawing date is July 28th. So
change that date to July 28th.
Yeah. And yeah, that should be good.
And add that document.
And add this document.
Yeah.
So so document five will be by Wetlands Preservation Incorporated. Okay. Here's the 20-foot easement. Anybody have any questions or comments about the order of conditions or need time to look over the order of conditions? Anybody need time to look over the order of conditions? Okay. You're going to look at it. You don't have any
Chuck, when did you have this order of conditions draft?
I finished that up this afternoon.
I would again request that we have order of conditions in advance of the meeting so we can read them, because the wrong date on the plans down the road could be a problem. We need a chance to be able to read these and make sure we're in concurrence.
Well, we have time right now. We don't have a full docket. Let's get through this. Fuel storage, issues with that. Any questions from the public at this point?
It's very confusing. I have to sit down and read it over.
Do you have any basic
there
or?
There was something here about not being notice of stormwater control and the maintenance requirements.
Can you tell us a page?
It is not the subject to the Mass stormwater standards.
What page are you on?
Page 7.
Page
the
7
forms?
Or 12?
The forms,
yeah, 7
the front
and 12,
matter?
Yeah. Right, no, under the bold print in the up about here,
yep.
The next line said it is not subject to the Massachusetts stormwater standards. What does that mean?
Do you see where she is?
Yep.
Yeah, number 19.
The work being performed for this project does not fit the criteria for the Massachusetts stormwater standards, which is a specific set of definitions that are for certain developments.
Okay.
Where you have to provide treatment, you have to provide infiltration, and this work doesn't meet that threshold.
Oh, okay.
That's all.
And these below are the conditions which they will meet, I presume.
The attached. Well, the standards would, those conditions would apply.
Right.
If it were subject.
And since it's not subject, those standards
so
don't apply.
A and B are not relevant. Am I correct?
I think A, B, C, D, F, G.
And I don't know what's on the next page.
It continues.
C and D and E.
Right to page 9.
So those are not relevant?
That's what this, that's what this says.
Right, right. If it's not subject to the stormwater standards, those are not relevant.
All up to A to F are not relevant.
Yes.
Okay.
That's what it ends at over there on
L.
No?
No, it keeps going.
L. Another page.
Yeah. Because it says continued at the top.
Right. So you would go from there, you go to the special conditions, so you keep going.
Keep going. There's more pages.
Page 10 for D. Because that C kind of stops and then.
So Brian, at what level, at what point would it become subject to the stormwater standards?
Well, if it was a if it was a subdivision, if it was new development,
somebody in car parking lot,
right?
Their whole list of
okay,
or redevelopment,
okay.
Right, right. This is all.
There's a question: if you're replacing catch basin on an existing street, does that fall under those? And we've have debated that issue, and I don't think we reached
consensus.
Conclusion.
Well, I think we know what Mass Highway says.
Right, but West Street does.
Because it's reconstruction. That's right. Actually, the issue is Mass DOT has changed their opinion about that over the years. The last 5 years, and they really now are requiring quite a bit of stormwater improvements when they rebuild roads like that, like West Street.
Right, what rebuild?
Paving is something completely
exactly,
different.
Exactly, that's what
completely different.
Right.
Okay.
On page 13, findings 2. I guess that's a typo. The along.
Just take out the.
Yeah.
I think in number 1, we have to say, the 20-foot drainage easement that falls within two parcels, because that within two parcels we're missing over here.
Where's the?
Right here. The work area is a 20-foot drainage easement that falls.
Or something like that.
Yeah, something like that.
There's. Okay, it's this one and that one. Okay. 152, right.
Falls was probably not the right.
Why don't you just take out the word that? Why don't you take out the word falls?
That's correct.
And that.
That's correct. Take those out. Yeah.
Drainage easement within
two parcels.
Right.
Of land.
Yeah.
That's
right.
Simpler.
Yeah.
Could I see the plan really quick?
Yeah.
On page 14, the last couple lines, you talk about a channel 4 feet in length and 2 feet. I should say in width, not in width.
Right, in width.
Okay.
Under number 5?
Under number 3?
Yep.
3.
So
page 14.
Looking at number 3, the new drainage line will be installed at the same diameter and the same inlet elevation of the existing system. It's actually a little bit lower because it's downstream of the existing inlet.
What's in number 3?
Yeah, the second paragraph.
What's the value of keeping that paragraph there?
Because it is covered in the plans.
Well, Well, the second part of that paragraph, anyway, the new drainage will enable a more effective means of handling flows, yada, yada, yada. It's a true statement and justification for allowing construction in the wetlands.
Yeah, yeah.
So I would make, you take that first sentence if you want, but I'd leave the...
So strike the first sentence of the second paragraph for number three on page 14.
At the same time, the same number?
Right, and then, so then that paragraph will start with, the new drain will enable a more effective means, and so on and so forth.
The new drain, the new swale and drain? What's it called on the plan?
Do they call it a swale?
Do they call it a swale? To the page right of the pipe?
The open channel?
Swale to existing swale.
Why don't we strike that first sentence and say the new swale and drain? Effective means of handling flows provides.
Is that in number four, that 410 square feet, is that based on the new plan or the old plan? Because we're actually permanently altering some square feet in the open channel.
Where's the, hold on, get a, what's the scale?
Probably 20.
1 to 20.
What's BBW?
The wetland line.
Oh, okay.
How long is that?
It's bordering vegetated wetlands.
That's what?
80 or 200?
That's 16, that's two, so that's 320 feet. No, it's 160 feet,
feet.
times.
20 feet.
Times 20.
Right, but the all... Yeah, but the all...
But it's 16. Not all in
no,
BBW.
No, the wetland area is right here.
Yeah.
Oh, all right, right. So it's approximately... I mean, what do you want to call it? Where's the one? You approximate.
You're the engineer. You're closer. You're a better perspective.
So...
There's a typo on 15.
15?
All right,
yeah.
So the disturbance is...
Yeah.
Yeah, hold that just for a minute. Let's
oh,
get
right.
through this one, then we'll get to that.
60, and I'd say the average is here, so it would be 60 by... 60 by 8, let's say. So temporary disturbance would be
well,
60 by 8. Maybe 60 by 10, so... What are they saying?
400.
410.
400.
So what are you saying?
So 60 by 8. I mean, I'm not, obviously not preliminary.
So that 410 is probably the... Is any of the...
410 is probably accurate for temporary disturbance. The actual permanent disturbance, which you'd have to subtract from that, is 50 by... by 2, so it'd be 100. So 100 would be permanent.
Is all that open channel in BBW?
Yeah.
Maybe all but like 10% of it, maybe,
okay.
Or 5% of it.
So we're permanently altering approximately 100.
And then temporary altering 310 or whatever the difference
okay.
is.
Okay, yeah.
Just 100.
Right. Right. I think that's probably accurate.
Okay. However, it will be restored in place.
Do we say that?
Yep.
Okay. That's good. Because that channel is...
I mean, we're permanently altering it, but it's going to be wetland.
Right.
So
it's still going to be
wetland.
Yeah.
Any other questions on page 14?
Great.
Page 15.
We had a typo on page 15?
Is that home, on the top of the page, it says a minimized flooding of adjacent homes, H-O-L-M-E-S?
Oliver Wendell Holmes.
That just hit
think,
me. As
I think property values just went up.
Notable area.
Maybe that was Sherlock.
Oh, my God.
It's easy to do, I have to say that.
Yep.
It's
So when you get down to a list of special conditions, you need to strike completely out 2 and 5.
That's a list of additional conditions, you mean?
Yeah.
Or special conditions. Additional
conditions.
Additional.
Page 15.
Page 15, you mean?
2 and 5.
In their entirety.
Yeah.
Okay.
They're left over from.
Okay.
Are those included or excluded?
Strike those.
They take them out.
Strike 2 and 5.
Do they have to get a 401 water quality certificate and 404 permit at Belmont and Ivy?
That's why I was right.
No.
At
Belmont and Ivy?
Yeah, that was right from
Real. A river crossing.
Have they gotten that Real. 404 permit?
I don't know. They
might only be. They have to get a 404 permit. It's not category 1.
I don't know.
I'm surprised.
Yeah, it's well, small. Talking? Belmont and I.
Oh, you know why? Because I think because they had to build a golf dam across that channel.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be my guess.
Is the 401s handled under the bylaws?
Under our bylaws?
Well, under the order of conditions, the 401 is taken care of, isn't it? Up to a certain threshold.
Yes.
That's never mentioned in here.
No,
it's
in
the state bylaw. The Corps of Engineers issued a general permit many years ago that if you comply with the wetlands, Massachusetts Wetlands
right.
Protection Act, then these things don't require 404.
Exactly.
401.
Yeah. But once you hit a certain threshold, you do.
Right.
Yeah. So, Chuck, on page 16, the DPW didn't, they're planning on doing this work in the fall?
I don't know when they're planning on doing this work. He said as soon as possible. So, which one are you talking about? What number?
Item
four.
Seven on page 16. And instead of 2, we want to replace that with shall. All work to take place.
Does it have to be the fall?
Doesn't.
Or can it be January if there's no rain, snow?
When it's it could be January.
Huh? Because that's what they said initially, that it might be done in January.
Hmm. Well, they can't seed in January.
Well, that's
Pardon
it.
Me?
The challenge is
they couldn't. Sorry, go
they
ahead.
Have to plant.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
So,
what date do you want? I don't know when they're starting. And maybe I can just say something immediately seeded.
How much time is this going to take? Just a couple of days?
I would think so.
Yeah, he told us.
I think a couple of days.
Yeah.
That's my memory, too.
Well, they have to set up on both sides. They can get across the stream in a day, but the whole thing is going to probably take longer than that.
Hmm.
They have to cut and cover. It's what?
Are we still talking about Belmont?
Oh, no, yes. God, what about the I'm thinking of Belmont.
What are you talking
about?
Get across
We're
the stream.
We're on Walnut Street.
Forget what I just said.
Okay. So there's no idea from engineering what's happening when they're planning on doing this Walnut Street work. Chuck, you haven't heard anything.
What's that?
You haven't heard when they're doing this work.
I refuse to answer that.
Okay.
Because
on the grounds that it might incriminate
yeah.
you.
I don't know when they're going to do the work. I think you know we. You know, that was basically a lot of the questioning at the last meeting.
Well,
so I don't know when they're going to do this work. And I know that George said that they may try to do it themselves, but if it looks too difficult, they're going to sub it out.
Well, they clearly have intent to do it because they're applying for this permit, so.
But also, if they're too busy, they would also sub it out, wouldn't they? Too much.
Instead of the October 1st deadline, do you want to say by the end... Sufficient to, I mean, within the growing season?
How about completed within
by the end
like
of the growing
one
season?
Week or something like that?
Sure.
What do you mean by then?
Well, we want to try and put some
closure on
when the planting has to happen.
How about
to make sure it does happen by a certain time?
If I could suggest, we don't want to limit it to the dry season or late summer, because that means it might not be done until 2015.
Hmm.
like.
Yeah.
And if they can do it during, when the ground's frozen, that's not a bad thing
dry
either.
Conditions is fine, or
yeah, all work take place in
within dry conditions.
In dry conditions,
right.
And all soils will be stabilized immediately, and planting shall occur at the earliest possible day given weather conditions or day given seasonal.
Right, because if they miss this season, we don't want to wait another year.
Exactly, that's
right.
What I'm
yeah.
trying to get.
Right.
So that's what
so
I'm
just
trying
get
to
get it
say.
And do it and plant as soon as you can.
Yeah.
Plant,
right.
Stabilize the soil and plant as soon as the season arrives.
Yeah.
Any chance of putting in there that they could plant things that repel mosquitoes?
I don't know if
that's a concern of mine with the water hanging around.
Well,
and there
like,
are plants, you know,
the
you
way
put
that,
in there.
The way this is designed, there should not be extended periods of standing water.
There won't be any?
I can't say there won't be, but it's designed
there
to
should
be
not
water.
There
should not be.
Okay.
If this works.
Unless we get some crazy rainstorms.
Right.
That
right.
flood everything.
We've had crazy rainstorms anyway.
But again, because the design is a sloped open channel at the beginning,
yeah.
it's not going to rely on somebody running a pump.
Right, right.
Okay,
no,
so it's gravity driven. It should be operating as well, long as there's
okay.
something there to cause gravity to
okay.
flow the water.
And the intake is a clog.
So there's not going to be a lot of dead water waiting to dry out.
Right.
Should all channel out.
Waiting to be pumped out somewhere else.
And it won't be pumped onto the street either, which is nice.
Yeah. yeah.
right.
It
right.
Right. goes right by my house.
Right. Small track excavation machinery. Is there...
What number are you on?
I'm just looking at number 8.
This way.
So,
yeah, contractor, we should probably just strike that and put in.
So they can come this way?
Work.
Yeah, it's drain easement.
Work shell.
Unless it's heavily vegetated. Oh, this way.
No, it's just open lawn, I think, between these two houses. They end up walking right through.
Rather than contractors, it might not be a contractor that does it. Say the work shell use or the... Yeah, the work shall
be performed
by.
What number you at, Jamie?
Number 8 on page 16.
Work, instead of contractor, cross strike contractor, replace it with work. Work shall be performed using, strike the word use, small tracked excavation machinery and other vehicles that will minimize likelihood of damage.
Oh, instead of contractor and 8, the work shall be performed by.
Yeah, because
yeah.
The
shall
10
be
might
performed
do.
Using small.
Right.
Or they might give all the neighbors a shovel and tell them to get out there and start digging.
I doubt it. The guy next door is pretty old.
Okay.
Are you on number 9?
12. I'm on 12.
Number 9 is a typo.
Which one?
The first sentence, number 9 on page 16.
Yep.
Second part of the sentence, then backfill with native excavated, there should be the word material added to meet the existing grade.
What's wrong with subsoil? Isn't it fine as is?
It doesn't say subsoil.
With excavated subsoil.
Oh,
the trench shall be backfilled with native excavated subsoil to the same depth as existing subsoil, and then backfill with native excavated material.
Native materials.
Soil, yeah.
Excavated materials.
Okay, so the third line. Insert materials. Or soils. Materials usually mean soils. In that
yeah, whatever they find in
so
there.
Yeah.
We could just say soil. Now they are, I seem to remember that George was not going to remove trees.
No,
he said he's going to try not to.
He's going
to
try not to.
There's some shrubs though, they're definitely not.
Right, actually, you know what, that's the whole wetlands. whole wetlands piece here. There was uplands, herbaceous, and they had a plants list. Here, okay. Yeah. Trees to actually continue to protect.
Anything for mosquitoes?
I'm not familiar with plants that are mosquito repellent by nature. I mean, I'm not saying they.
No, I looked it on the web. There are some plants that do. They really are, and that they're shade plants. And I didn't bring them with me tonight, but there are some.
Are they native plants?
Yeah, I think they are. One is basil, but you wouldn't want to put basil there. But there are others like.
I'd like
catnip
basil,
is one, but you wouldn't
nice.
Want to put that either because
there's
the cat would go crazy
over
it. But there are others that I didn't bring the list with me. But there are several others that will work in the shade. Do you know what I mean? There are people who know about agriculture would know that, or
like marigold
landscaping.
Or something, or?
Marigold is one actually, because
yeah,
we have them in our garden. Yeah,
we use them
yeah,
to keep the bees away from the roses.
Yes, yes, they do.
I don't have an objection to that idea per se. I
no,
just
I just
don't
thought
know.
Through it out. If,
yeah.
If they can, it would help. I don't know. A lot of, there are no children there now, particularly.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I suspect that neighborhood's going to change, and they're going to be like when my children were little, there were going to be a lot of children running
in the back area.
They were
yeah.
a lot.
Sure. I'm sure it will happen.
Comes in cycles.
They have a proposed planting plan, and it's
the children on cycles.
Yes.
And it's herbaceous cover, so lower plants like grasses and
yeah.
flowers that are more friendly, that are more tolerant of a wet environment.
Okay, that makes
and,
sense. That's great.
Partridge pea.
If you wanted to independently take that up with the engineering division, and you know.
I
drop it in their lap.
I don't know if they want to hear from me, so I don't know.
That's true.
Okay. Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
You can still bring it up with them if you so so deep. Anything else on page 16? Page 17. Any questions or comments? Storage, pollutants. Okay.
What does that mean about fuel storage?
Fuel storage. Go ahead, Terry.
Number 14, right?
Yep. Would you like to explain?
No, I just don't know where it was.
We commonly request that a distance be kept of machinery and hazardous liquids be stored.
Oh.
You know, a safe distance from wetlands, you know, in event that something's mistakenly spilled or, you know, that it, you know, safe distance of hazardous chemicals is always a good idea. So we just write that into our orders of condition that while they're doing their, while they're doing their refueling of their machines, maybe they'll bring a fuel.
Oh, you mean like a lawnmower?
The gas can.
Yeah, maybe a gas can with them.
Yeah.
You know, to
okay.
refuel their oil or whatever their machines or whatever. So, any other questions on page 17? I didn't see any issue with that.
In the narrative, these ones that are listed,
yeah,
like flood control, stuff like that.
Go
is
ahead.
That, what does that pertain to? I mean, why is it? Because it says proposed reading bylaw is 7.1:, and then you have these. Seven things listed.
What we're listing there are the interests of the act that this order is protecting.
Okay.
Have I got that right, Chuck?
I assume that's what
attention.
It was. But
the narrative for Reading
on
General
page 17? Is that what you said?
Yeah,
yep,
the very bottom
page 17 at the end.
The last two lines and the first one on the next page. I guess,
those you go to the front, the very front where the form five, those forms with form five and the special conditions that are just part of that form.
That basically from as a spillover from the Wetlands Protection Act, as we've incorporated it under our bylaw, there are certain values that we are charged to protect, and we are just listing what those values are.
Okay.
Otherwise known as the interests of the act.
Yeah, I know we changed the section of bylaws that were the weapons. I can't remember if the change was to section 7 or section 5, but we have both of them here.
Yeah, that all should be 7.1.
7.1 is what it should be.
So on the bottom of page 17, in the title, it should say section 7.1.
You got it.
Yep.
And similarly on page 18 in the title.
Yeah. Now we're not requiring any bounds on this.
George, run them up. Please don't.
Okay.
What do you guys think about not having this recorded?
Well, whose property is it on?
Well, it's two separate private properties.
Two separate private properties, yeah.
But is there a town easement?
There is a town easement.
Mm-hmm. No, because there's no...
I already have the easement.
No structure. I don't think it needs to be recorded. I do think, though, and I didn't see it in here, is there any provision for maintenance of this thing?
No, it's not even in operation.
We should probably make sure that's in there.
Hold on. Is that easement existing?
I'm pretty sure it is.
This is existing drainage easement. We need to look at the language in the drainage easement, and that would count what's allowed to happen in there.
For maintenance?
Now, it wouldn't necessarily cover wetland maintenance, but it covers the access to maintain what's there.
In the drain easement?
In the drain easement.
Just
right.
Language.
Yeah. I think we could, though, add to this a requirement that they check that intake periodically or after major storms to make sure it's not clogged.
At least annually.
Yeah, I think that makes sense because that's critical to having this operate properly.
And they do have a planning plan. Do we have a provision to go in at a certain amount of time and check to see if it was successful?
We do not on this one.
Well, let's put that in. Would that be a special condition? We don't have anybody representing engineering to be here to object in person.
So yeah, they're not objecting, so I'm
right,
saying let's put it in.
And this is to...
Just to make sure the things they plant...
Oh, the plantings. Okay.
Yeah, survive.
They're generally pretty good about that, too. So
that would be what? A3?
Say after 1 year.
Anybody want to volunteer some language? Jamie, you've begun.
After 1 year, the applicant shall submit a report to the Conservation Commission.
Yeah, we have that in a couple other documents. I'll just grab it from that.
And then put in that maintenance of that intake to be
ongoing.
Inspected and cleaned as necessary. Is once a year adequate?
You mean take the mud out at the end of spring, so before somebody else?
Yeah.
I'm thinking
debris,
more
grass,
debris is clogging that intake and stopping it. And
leaves.
So when would you do it?
I would.
Because I was thinking more of silt and mud and leftover storm stuff and
hopefully
stuff that settles in there.
At a minimum annually?
I'm trying to think. I can't remember. Are we doing... What site are we doing?
This is Walnut Street.
Well, we would want it... probably up to spring high water and maybe...
How about before the spring flood?
Yeah, that'd be good, too.
That would be good.
When's the spring flood?
Late March.
But if there's a snow cover, they can.
Yeah, because I think of.
After snow melt.
May.
You want to say after snow melt.
After snow melt, that's good.
Maintenance of intake after snow melt.
Inspection and maintenance is required.
Mm-hmm.
Or as they say, I'm going to put some ice out.
Ice out, yeah, exactly. So the pipe intake to be inspected and maintained, cleared of debris at a minimum annually after snow melt. And prior to spring.
So you have A3 and A4. One is that planting will be maintained, and then the second one is cleaning out the intake.
Is the planting plan on the plan?
Is the what?
No, it's a separate document dated August 13th, unless I'm on the previous
that's
application.
The one I
yeah, no, you're on the right one.
Good.
So, do you want me to read this briefly, just to refresh everybody about what the planting plan is?
You betcha.
All right, let's see. Wetland and buffer zone planting plan. While it's expected that the soils used to backfill the trench will include a number of viable seed sources, the area to be restored, the wetland will be seeded with a wetland restoration seed mix. The content of this seed mix is provided in the attached table. The seed mix includes a number of indigenous wetland plant species as well as grass, which will act to rapidly stabilize the soil surface within the restored wetland area. As a result of the access required to the site by heavy equipment to excavate the trench and casting of soil from the trench to the side, the entire width of the existing easement within the erosion control barrier will be disturbed to some degree. Disturbed soil areas will be sown with a mixture of uplands, grasses, and forbs to stabilize exposed soil areas. Wetland areas temporarily disturbed will be sown with a wetland seed mix as specified in Table 1. So there's a list of, so they have on the table.
So we're going to get a grass report after 1 year.
Although it says several small trees and shrubs will be removed.
There are two plants.
So I thought it was all
well.
Grasses. That's why I was kind of
asking what the
plan was.
There's arrowwood and something else.
Arrowwood's really, really tough.
You know, they...
What else is on
they
that?
They talk about
arrowwood.
wetlands... They're only talking about what using the wetland
and arrowwood
seed.
And silky dogwood.
And they have a shrub list, but there isn't a mention of shrubs being planted.
So they have arrowwood.
Well, maybe
grass,
we should.
They have arrowwood that's in the wetland. Silky dogwood is next to the wetland. So that's for the tree that's going to be taken down.
Well, maybe we should say in condition A3 that any trees to be removed will be replaced with
shrubs.
From the list. From table one.
Right.
There are a lot of shrubs in there now. I assume they probably will come back in naturally.
They probably will, but we're going to lose a lot of them because of to get in there, you know. So.
Yeah, so I think we inspect it after a year to make sure that it is returned to approximately existing conditions. If not, they're going to have to make it so, number one.
Have you ever bought that wetland seed mix? That stuff is expensive.
There's some at the co-op that's not so bad. Have you bought it there? Because the stuff out in Hadley is very expensive.
$100 a pound.
Yeah. Ooh.
$100 a pound.
Yikes.
But it. Have you ever seen an area after they've used it? You could almost have a class on grasses and whatnot there.
Yeah.
You're like, wow.
Yeah, it is.
So do you have the language for A3 and A4, roughly? I know some of that
roughly,
is going to come
from
somewhere else.
Which
any trees taken down will be replaced from the plan.
Will be replaced with
shrubs.
Because that is not in this plan.
So trees are going to be replaced with shrubs.
Right.
Yeah.
So the shrubs from the list will replace
from
the
list,
yeah.
The list.
And are we saying that they have to maintain the plantings?
And they have to...
They have to
ensure.
Don't we have
you know, they have to go back and inspect the plantings to ensure
just
that they.
Just 1 year.
Yeah.
Submit a report documenting conditions of revegetation. And
okay. So follow-up reporting.
correct as necessary at the direction of the Conservation Commission.
Yep. And then A4, the pipe intake to be inspected and maintained clear of debris at a minimum of annually following the snow melt and prior to spring. Spring high water table.
So the neighbors can help enforce that. If it's clogged, you can tell them they're required under this order
to come.
Yeah.
Yes, we will tell them that.
Yeah.
Or move the branch yourself.
Any other questions or comments from the public or the commission about this?
One thing. When
yes,
you're talking about
ahead.
Like the 100 and 300 thing, should that be here or should we just move it off 410? When you were talking about like all that math and stuff.
Oh right.
the area, the disturbed
area?
Yeah,
just because it all says 410.
It all says 410.
What page are you on?
Yeah, we should
right there.
Three,
change it
page
every
page 3 of 12.
Good catch.
So she was saying we need to put the 100 and then make this 310 instead. That the proposed alteration permitted and proposed replacement permitted replacement.
Why?
I suppose.
Why is that?
I was just curious because we were talking about it.
Well,
really
that is specifically for if you fill a wetland area and then you replace a wetland, like somewhere else.
Oh, okay. All
so
right.
the proposed replacement would be in compensation for.
Oh, okay. So
yeah.
Okay.
Since we just
yeah.
sort of
okay.
reconfiguring what's there.
Yeah,
it's,
so
it's
that's probably
sure.
okay.
Oh, that's okay. There's a lot to these things.
Yeah.
It's actually
okay.
a wetland regrading area.
Okay. Any other questions or comments about this order of conditions? Okay, I'll entertain a motion to approve the order of conditions as amended tonight. Go ahead and make the motion.
Did you? Oh, did you
to
ask? Did you
the
make
order
it?
No,
so
moved.
Moved.
So
I will entertain.
So moved. I thought you
okay.
made a motion.
That's okay. And a second?
I second that.
Okay. All those in favor? Okay. Opposed? None. No abstentions.
I couldn't get the words out. Sorry.
Do we need to close? We've closed the hearing already.
It's already been closed.
You need to sign.
We need to sign. I'm ready
to
sign.
We do have a lot of changes to it.
I trust. Chuck
well,
can make
I can,
those.
I can send them out. You can look through it. It wouldn't be a bad idea. It is a town. Yeah, he's not starting right away.
Yeah.
We
need
all
this.
Those things.
Yeah.
But.
Okay.
Could I get a signed copy of the changes? With the changes?
We don't have a copy with
we
the changes.
We don't have a final.
No, when it's done. I don't expect it now.
It's a public document. I don't know if we can give
where
you
would it,
make a copy.
Would it be on the web, or what do I do?
No,
that?
It's not.
Just
on
come
the
into town hall and request one,
okay.
or call and
in
request.
A couple of weeks, a week.
By Monday or Tuesday.
Okay, great.
This one's finished. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thanks for coming in.
Okay.
Thank you. We're gonna miss you. You've been with us for several months.
I figured if we didn't sign it, she was going to send her neighbor back.
He's getting sick little neighborhood on us.
Neighborhood.
All right. Okay.
All right, let's move through
are
the
we
scene.
Done
okay.
with that? Okay.
We have one thing in the agenda, and it's 9:30.
I know. Because we're thorough. We're that good. Okay. Sorry. All right. This, that, the other. This. Okay. Let's get to Chuck, if you don't mind. Let's get started with the minor projects. Talk of old new business.
None of those minor projects really need to be discussed, but I think they all fell in compliance with our minor project. I just wrote down what they were. Play area, deck, chain link fence we talked about. That's the Arlington, the Reading land, the Reading Housing Authority.
Sounds good.
Two emergency permits came in. I think this, again, is part of our letter writing campaign. I'd like the commission to sign each one of these. It was four trees that were determined to be just a hazard. The first one's for 87 Avalon Road. And it's Polanski is the tree contractor for that. And I did go out and do a site visit each time and see what's happening. And the next one is another tree, and that's within striking distance. That first one, that tree was struck by lightning. They tried to save it 2 years ago.
Wow.
And it's more than two-thirds of the canopy is missing and gone, and it's all dead. So it was a good effort, but worked out.
That worked.
So just to reiterate, so Chuck, I don't know if we all heard that part, but so these two emergency permits are in response, are tree companies you're hearing from, kind of?
Polanski's new. Northeast Tree consistently calls.
Yeah. Okay.
They're top-notch group over there.
Polanski's been around for a long time.
Yeah, I've seen
been
him.
Around. I don't think I've worked with them as much as I have Northeast. So.
But it's nice to hear that you're getting called.
I'm getting called. I'm out there immediately and making decisions quickly.
Yeah,
so
that's
I think
good.
That's
nice and
need.
Clean and easy.
That's good.
Yep.
Yeah.
I'm glad to hear it. Okay.
We took care of the orders of conditions, and I'll skip down to the administrator's report. And at the last meeting, it was Will had some issues with the website. We looked into it, identified a few things where there were some small changes that we could make. And one, we did check out the downloads that were on there, and they worked for me and they worked for Ann. So I'm not sure what the problems were, but I was going to ask Will, who's not here tonight, to just write them down. We'll just work on them as we see,
okay.
As we have time, which is usually once a week or once every 2 weeks.
Okay, so that's the next step, is like another kind of ongoing meetings about it.
No, but I'm going to turn it into a big deal. If
okay.
Will has some issues,
okay.
He needs to write them down. We'll take care of them. Anyone sees anything, we do. This is something we do
yep.
all the time. People come in and say, your application, I couldn't figure out a certain part of it. You should say you should allow mailing certificates, not just green cards. And we made that change. So we're constantly making changes as
yeah.
people mention things.
Yeah.
So
good.
Okay.
Peter Sanborn Place, I met with Jacqueline Carlson tonight. And I have something I can write up, but in my opinion, I don't get what.
It's ornamental, is it not?
Yeah.
Then
so
it's
are you thinking it's not even a minor
I
permit?
I could go over it.
It's
if,
a non-issue.
I have some. I could see where the wetland was, and there's some sensitive fern right there on the edge,
yeah.
And then it comes right out to the lawn. So you expect that maybe it goes into the lawn a little bit,
yeah.
But then the land comes up a bit. There's pine trees, and you can see that it probably cuts right back into the wooded area and then down. So that's probably the point right there. So all that work is within 100 feet. But what she wants to do is take down trees that are, they're you know, pines and whatnot, but they're dead at the bottom.
Yeah.
They're dead two-thirds of the way up. Some of them, they're overgrown. They've outlived their usefulness. And then along a fence, she wants to take these ones down that are only have needles at the top. So I did not ask her how she was going to do this. I would assume the roots are coming
these,
out too.
These are mature pine trees?
No.
Do you remember over at Peterson Place with the playground and my kids?
Yeah, there's that one. There's that one conifer there by the play yard.
But then there's one to the left. Yeah, there's two.
One little one.
And then there's the fence trees.
These are trees.
But they've all been planted by. They've all been planted by
Peter
Sanborn
Place.
Peter Sanborn
yeah.
Place. I don't
right.
think they're native.
Yeah.
Well, those two up by the play area are definitely better. I thought you were
yeah.
talking
no,
about
No, I know what you're talking
in the
about.
The wetlands.
And the resource area.
Where's the play area? Are you standing in the play area?
Yeah. Here's the other two trees they want to take down, dead at the bottom.
Holy
yeah.
crap.
You guys seeing this?
You didn't. I saw those.
No, I've seen them, but they look worse. I think the deer are well fed.
Yeah, they're not dead. They're just.
Yeah,
deer.
right to that
right
one
right
level.
Where,
yeah,
it's like all the way around.
One dramatic.
Yeah. Chuck, you having a snack while you're up?
Yeah.
Here's the play area. I'm standing in the driveway.
Yeah.
There's a play area in front of you. And the fence runs along this area right here.
Yeah.
And then the land runs back. She wants to remove all whatever they are type of trees, which are probably just
arborvitae
edge type.
Yeah.
I think they are, yeah.
It wasn't pine. It wasn't white pine. And then just those two pines I showed you, and that's all. And she wanted to replant them with something else.
See, that sounds different from what I understood she was explaining.
I didn't have time to work on this.
Yep.
I mean, I just really ran there and ran back.
Well, I thought she was talking about, let's she wants to take the two pines out and then put some bushes in over in the corner.
So
into the property here. Then you turn down.
Yeah.
There's the play area right
there.
Yeah. The trees and the brush along this area she wants to come over.
We wanted to know where she was going to do it.
So
she's not
one right here.
Yeah,
now
she's just getting rid of the trees.
This is where I think the wetland is, like
the side. So she wants to take one that's actually in the wetland?
No, nothing was actually in the wetland unless you want to really get down and check the grass out.
So is this in the wetland?
That is where I'm asking where the sensitive fern is.
Okay.
You marched right through that to find that little ditch.
Right.
Yeah. You saw how the sensitive fern just started at one point.
Right.
Well, that's where she was.
Yeah.
So really it was these big overgrown trees that she just wants to put something back in that's easier to manage.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what I'm hearing from her.
So you're...
I don't have a plan. I can change this into something that people understand better. She didn't try to rush me to get something done tonight.
Well, she should do that, not you.
Okay.
But
if she wants to submit a plan or flag the one she wants to cut, we can go ahead and look at it, but you shouldn't be doing that.
But I think what she does need to hear from us is it a minor permit? Is it an RDA? Is it an NOI? So out of those three, or just a letter to us saying, I intend to do this.
I think it falls under our bylaw. It falls under landscape lawn maintenance. It's in the lawn. It's in the existing lawn, is it not?
Isn't this
similar to Full Farm Lane or whatever it is?
So it's maintenance?
I think it's within the existing lawn, but our bylaw says if you want to remove a planting, you can replace it with a substantially similar planting or something like that. How is it worded?
Something to the effect, if it's a, we don't use the word ornamental, but if it's changing one landscape species to another landscape species, you don't even need a problem.
Right.
I don't have a problem with that, the two pine trees. I'm just wondering what else is she thinking of taking out. At one point it was like, take out the poison ivy and put in blueberries, and now I'm hearing, well, it's the other side, and we're taking out this whole row of things.
Yeah.
That's it.
South side of the property, right? That's on the
fence.
It comes down to, go ahead and talk.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, it really, none of that matters. Everything she mentioned, whether it's this, that, or the other thing, where she wants to do it is fine.
That's right.
Right.
It didn't need
it's still existing.
What we did to her, which is make her wait all summer.
She's not marching in the woods and pulling, sensitive
fern
out of the ground.
She wants to, on her existing lawn, there's only two, and I would say they have to be at least 50 feet away from the sensitive fern.
Yeah.
You know, I agree that everything's in, the buffer, but if she's just swapping it out. So a plan makes sense, but I don't know if it has to be off the top shelf.
Well, then what's the sense of commission? If the work is within the existing grass lawn, she doesn't need, and she's planting natives.
But she has an obligation to replace whatever she takes out. That's my only concern. If she's the two pine trees, okay, she replace it, but whatever else she takes out, she should replace it with something else.
I think that's the way it's worded in our bylaw. If you're gonna swap, even for a species, you don't have to file. But if they're just planning to take it out and do something different,
that's different.
Right.
That's different.
Or if she's getting it out of existing lawn, that's different.
Right.
But if she's in existing lawn, taking down one landscape species and putting up another, she didn't even need to file or do anything.
Right.
Okay.
The only thing I was worried about was, you know, they're taking out the root ball and, you know, that, and with all those trees along the fence, that's going to be a lot of work. But still, if that's the what's how it's written, she just replaces them.
Right.
She's going to take out the root ball?
Those trees are pretty big. So
I know they are.
It's going to be hard to plant
anything
there. That's going to
be a big hole.
What are you talking about for a trunk size? Like
that? From that picture,
yeah, those
it looked
were pretty
like
big.
That.
Really?
Well, maybe.
Isn't that what they were from that picture? It looked like to me.
The ones along the fence were probably only like 6 inches at the most.
But the one next to, the large one next to the playground is like...
Well, that's a pine tree. Those are,
yeah.
That's not a pine tree. We've been through this.
Yeah, we did.
Sorry.
Yeah.
It's not a pine tree.
I kept calling it a pine tree, too.
It's only 6 inches.
Yeah.
And definitely, just it's too big to manage at this point. They can't do anything with it.
Okay. So it sounds like the consensus of the commission, unless there's any, you know, other dissenting comments or please speak up, is go for it.
I'd make a suggestion. So it's... at least write down what we're going to do, whether I go out there one more time and or she submits, this is what I'm taking out 20 of these and I'm replacing them with 20 of those.
But
so I can go back and say, okay, great,
yeah.
Because it may change every time.
Right.
I've only been out there
right.
Twice.
Just specify it's in an existing lawn.
Mm-hmm.
That makes a big difference. If it's
yeah.
an existing lawn,
if it's a,
we're pretty much yeah. okay with it. But if she starts to get into that wooded area,
she has
that,
no intention of going. She
yeah.
said that,
right,
but
right.
But as long as we make that, it has to be clear to her. Within existing lawn, replacement one for one.
I mean, she wants to make it look nice, but I don't think anyone's ever been over in that area. I mean, that play structure looks brand new, and there was no, you know, there was no wood chips even off the timber.
when we were there, there was a resident sitting there reading his newspaper.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep, he was.
Okay.
And he was happy to have company.
And we had some kids running around there.
Yeah,
yeah.
That was Nika's kids.
Yeah. yeah.
They were the first ones to use it.
So no permit needed.
No.
No.
Okay.
As long as you
just
she understands
the
conditions.
So the only other thing is I just made a note that 1102 Main Street, the driveway, the demo work has started.
Which is 1102?
It's right next to Artist, where we...
Yes, that driveway.
Oh, right. I saw that.
The driveway.
We incorporated the driveway remodel into the Artist site. But 92 Sanborn Lane has also started.
Has?
This site work will be starting next week. But we've done our pre-activity meeting. They put in the sill fence and hay bale. And the only question that came up with that was Al wanted to know, I guess a couple people mentioned cleaning up in back. He wanted to know, what does that mean? Is he going back there with equipment or just what he sees visually on top of those rocked area? I didn't see any piles of like brick. So it would be just metal and PVC pipe is what I saw.
I think I saw a 1956 car seat in there or something.
I think
actually
it
was an old one.
I think the understanding was as you walk that wetland line, and I hope my memory serves me well, but as you walk that wetland line, as you're walking that line, you can look back up at the slope of that the fill coming in there, and you see stuff sticking out.
There's all kinds of stuff.
And you walk on stuff that you should not be walking on in a wetland that does not belong there. So cleaning that up, taking that out, removing at least the superficial, what is visible.
Right, but we don't want destabilize that.
I really, really hate to say it, but I think you start pulling stuff out of there, you're just gonna keep going.
Well, that is
so
an issue because there's
top.
Trees grown in there too. So,
and you know, obviously we're dialing with Al, so he had another suggestion. He said instead of pulling it out,
cover it up.
he said
you can get a machine back there, pound it into the ground, and then it'll put topsoil over the top
of it.
That might be the best.
That
might be the best solution.
Now wait, if you pound it into the ground, you're going to change
the
porosity permeability of that.
Isn't that the line right there, and you're going to put topsoil over it? I just laughed. I said, "Yep, okay," but I didn't realize.
I mean, but Brian's right. If you start pulling that stuff out of there, you're going to destabilize
I'm telling you, you get
that
this stuff,
slope, and
you're
going to
pull it
erosion.
Out, you're
going
to see something else, you're going to pull that out.
But
I think we're talking about two different things. I thought it was
what's visible, and I don't want him digging through the stone to get something. It's just what's on top, and there were maybe 10 things on top.
Well, I saw what looked like a gasoline island in there, so.
Yeah, so did I.
You wonder what else is in there.
But he's not pulling that out.
But that's what I'm saying, you can see it.
You can see it, it's visible along the slope.
Talk about a can of worms, I mean.
Well, we just go through there, and then you guys can look at it when the certificate of compliance comes up. I mean,
it might make more sense rather than pounding it into the ground.
Make that slope uniform with topsoil and let stuff grow.
Topsoil it and seed it, and that's it.
But let me just say, though.
It's how you close the landfill.
Well, let me just say, at a minimum, though, the extra debris that is scattered in the wetlands beyond the toe of slope should come out.
That, I think, is...
There's a seat. There's a bucket seat.
No. You see a car seat, take it out.
Can't pound that in.
There's a white.
Especially stuff that's rolled down the hill and is now 10 feet.
Although
in
I have to tell you, at this point, Chuck, it's probably habitat for a couple salamanders.
It probably
is.
You'll pull it out, there'll be a blue spotted salamander come running out.
So,
okay, the guys will be disappointed, but okay, I'll tell them.
Pounding the seed into the ground.
Yeah, don't. They should just cover the soil and plant knotweed.
No. Or okay. Kudzu, hell.
Yeah. It's coming up anyway. So, any other thing come
I
up?
Do. I do. I have a quick thing. Was it Jamie I was talking to? There's a new invasive species in town.
Oh, yeah.
Although, it may not be new. It may fool you into thinking it's grapes.
I thought it was grapes.
All right, and I did too.
Oh, I've seen this.
It's called porcelain berry. The stuff that I've seen online says that it's possibly invasive, and I'm telling you, it grows fast.
I know, I've got it in my yard.
And it looks just like grape leaves.
Well, keep it on your side of the street.
Just the weeds. There are berries. I removed some this weekend, and I'll tell you, that runner, I pulled it. It was like a zip cord that went right over to my neighbor's yard about 25 feet away. The good thing is it comes out nice and easy. You just pull it, and the thing keeps coming. But...
The bad thing, it grows right back.
Probably reseeds through fragmentation.
I'll tell you. Hopefully that's not the case, but...
What did you do with it when you pulled it out? You didn't put it in the compost?
Oh, it's in the compost. Yeah, it's growing down there now.
Like everything
yard.
Else.
So I also pulled out some multiflora rose in my neighbor's yard. I don't know what's going on in my neighbor's yard. There's 5 different invasive species over there. But they haven't made it to my yard yet, and I got a little treat for them when they do. So, but I did all that this weekend, and the multiflora rose runners are much harder to get out of the ground. Probably with the weed wrench, they probably come out a little bit easier. But I have seen this new invasive species climbing all over trees and in different communities.
Porcelain berry.
Yeah, and so it's kind of nasty. But that was a lot of fun. So.
Okay.
Yep.
That's where you've been. Anything else, Chuck? Did you get to 34 Oak Street?
Run off a couple of things.
Yeah.
We have a request to have a meeting after the 24th by someone who's being pressured by his
wife.
The owner of a house.
Oh.
But he, you know, he was well aware of what was going on and just discovered tonight that we weren't having the meeting on the 24th because it's Rosh Hashanah. So no meeting here tonight. We scheduled the meeting on the 17th, but I have no applications, so I suggest that we cancel that meeting. There's nothing coming up.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll miss the 24th, and he asked if we would do one right after that to just for him and for his client.
That's Halloween? No, it's until September.
So,
no, it's October. We're talking about
it wasn't our fault, but you know, that's the request. And the next meeting would be October 8th.
That'd be October 1.
October 8th.
But he's requesting a meeting after Rosh Hashanah, which would be the 1st.
We only have Wednesdays available here. I'd have to call around to see if something is available. We could do something. But
for what? I mean, it's not a hearing, though, is it?
It will be a notice of intent.
It is a notice of intent, okay.
Has he submitted it yet?
No. As a matter of fact, we rushed to get him his abutters notice, and that came in on time to make the last deadline, but he didn't take that opportunity. So, I think things were happening. It came in like the day before I needed it, and he just couldn't put the rest together.
But you still don't have it.
He just said he wanted me to request it. He's not breaking anyone's arms. I don't have it. No, I have nothing. I have absolutely nothing.
So you don't even know what it is. I mean, it may not even. I mean, we have.
I do know what it is.
We have one. Okay.
It's a house that wants to put a garage in the back, and it's within, I don't know, 50 feet of bordering vegetated wetland. And the other question was, it's right near the entrance to Austin Prep. Remember, Jamie told me something about this.
There's a registered vernal pool there.
Okay, there's a vernal pool. It's on the opposite side.
Across the street?
Across the street from the entrance.
I'm not worried about that, then.
Where does the Abajona River go? Above Austin Prep, or how it shows on
Willow Street. Willow Street.
And is it perennial?
And West Street, it becomes riverfront.
As soon as it crosses... As soon as it crosses Willow, that's Willow.
Or West Street.
So, because...
Well, that would make him on the non...
Right.
Non-riverfront side. And he's across pavement from a vernal pool, so I don't think there's an issue there as well.
Have you ever looked at USGS? Because it shows the Abajona going above Austin Prep, not the way it's shown on our GIS.
So yes, we've been through this.
It's pretty heavily studied. Yeah.
But I just want to tell him that it goes below it. It's exactly like it shows on RGIS, and it's perennial on that side of the street.
On the opposite side.
The opposite side from the entrance.
Yeah.
No.
No, within the vicinity.
Downstream of West Street, it's river. Upstream of West Street.
Oh, west is way down.
West,
oh,
right.
Okay. Is not. Okay, good.
Upstream of West Street, it's a intermittent stream.
So in other words, between West Street and Lowell, it's intermittent.
Right.
So it doesn't matter.
But
so
that's where he is.
Well,
I've never seen it not
that's
flowing, weird. Though.
He's between West Street and Lowell.
Yeah, he
so
is.
He's on the non-perennial side.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
Terry,
we
had
question.
An owner camp out there and take pictures, videos,
during
continual
the 4 days.
Videos of that thing, and then deliver them at our house.
That's
to
awesome.
Show that it didn't flow.
That is awesome.
That looks pretty big for not flowing, and it's named. One of the first things that people told me when I got here was, if it has a name, which it does on our GIS, then it's perennial.
Then it's perennial.
And it has a name right there.
But
if you look at the regulations, there are a number of criteria.
One square mile drainage area.
Can make it a riverfront.
Yeah.
And one of them is have a name on a USGS map. But if you can demonstrate conclusively that the drainage area is less than...
1 square mile.
Is it 1 square mile? Some amount.
Very easy to do today with stream stats.
They did that, and we beat them up, and we had George check it and everything else, and...
It's very easy to do. I could do it on a laptop.
It's fine. So that takes care of that. And about the meeting, this seems like there's no one wants to honor that request.
When does he want to do it?
I don't know. We could only do it on
the
1st.
The only Wednesday available would be October 1st.
No, I'm sorry. When does he want to build this thing? Is he in a big... Does he
have
his building permit?
I didn't question him.
Well, if he has his building permit and ready to go... Then I'd be receptive to a special meeting. But if he didn't have his building permit, then no.
If he just asked if he wasn't honored, if I would have the order ready for the meeting that he's at.
Well, let me say, it sounded to me after talking with you that you had sort of a time period before the meeting that you need to receive documents.
Right.
That was acceptable. Now, since we don't have a meeting on the 17th, so we're skipping a meeting.
17th, you mean the 24th.
Or the 24th of September.
Right.
That the next available time to meet would be October 1st, 2 weeks before that is the 17th.
No, it wouldn't be the 1st, it would be the 8th. Oh, the first available
if
time.
The first available
not our
time.
Regular scheduled
right.
meeting.
The 8th is a regular meeting, though.
Right.
Of October.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So at that point,
so
he'd be kind of like, what's the point?
The
he'd be gaining 5 work days by coming a week earlier.
Yeah, I'm only bringing it forward. If you ask my opinion,
let's just move it to the 8th.
Yeah, I wouldn't
why don't we just do that?
I don't like changing for, you know, it's just, it's hard enough. I mean, obviously, we've struggled with getting things done on our regular schedule. That might screw up the next one.
Right.
So, all right, I have the answers for that.
Okay.
And we talked about the meeting, and then there's 29 Gavin Circle, sent out the enforcement order. The Fastalos looked through that, and they had some questions, and they said, oh, we just want to make sure that you understand that we're going to level certain areas, as it says in the document that was provided by their guy. What's his name?
Dr. Rockwood?
Yeah, John Rockwood. So we never got into a plan that showed elevations in this leveling, and I didn't, although it does say leveling in it, it seemed to me that what they were talking about was depressions made by a rock, a stone, being removed from these areas, and then that would be flattened out. They always talked about raking it, which I get. We're going to get the stones out of there, and then we're going to seed it. But this leveling, just that's just too vague for me at this point. So we had gone back and forth a few times. So I don't, we're at, you know, they want to get started, and they're talking about leveling something now, and I'm not sure what that means. So
they
asked them to call me, which they didn't. And they just sent me a couple of emails, and they just said, oh, no, it says to, you know, I'm just paraphrasing. It just says that we can level, but when I read it, I don't get the same understanding as they do out of that. The leveling, like I said, was an area by the retaining wall so they can repair it in the future. And the other part specifically mentioned raking and leveling out depressions. So I don't see that whole area as a depression, and I was worried about that. So I did talk to Brian about this, and he suggested getting a detail, which makes sense if they want to move forward or modify the enforcement order.
Cross-section.
Yeah.
A couple of cross-sections.
Yeah. Through the slope, showing us the wetland line, 25-foot line, and what the grade's going to look like up at the top.
What it was before the screwed up whole thing.
I thought we were talking about the different levels and what the gradients would be in each of them with Rockwood.
Well, we probably
there were three different sections, and they should have this pitch, this with this pitch.
I want to know how the slope is going to transition. If they want to level something, when I say level, I mean flat level.
Yeah, they're going to put a badminton court.
To get from the flat section to the wetland, there has to be a slope in between, and what is the slope going to be? Right. That's our concern.
Right.
Right. Well, that's what I thought.
They can level all they want as long as they're not going to create an erosive slope.
Right. But that wasn't when Rockwood presented his stuff. He wasn't talking about the first 15 feet with this gradient, the next feet would have this.
I believe he did review that.
Yeah, I thought we had that.
But I don't know if he specifically talked about what was happening up on the...
Up
closer to the street.
Right. I don't know that he was specifically talking about that.
Yeah.
I can't recall.
At one point, they wanted to build that up to make it a yard.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I was just afraid of agreeing to something called leveling.
Well, we need to know, understand clearly what that means. Is it more fill? Is it just simply... moving around the fill that's the material that's there now.
Well, that could
what
be
is
an
that?
Issue because there's a lot of material. Yeah, you could scoop it all out at one end and flatten out the other. But that might not be what they're doing. So,
however they can clarify that, let's
have
get
them
that
come
solidified.
In with some drawings.
Okay. You know, are they talking about minor depressions like 3 to 4 inches? Or are they talking about?
Yeah, I don't know.
It's very unclear from what they're saying. They're using terminology
or?
That I'm not used to.
Right.
I mean, it's just
the
leveling is too vague. I mean,
it's very vague.
And they're pointing to something else in a document that describes leveling and then tells you what it's actually leveling. So to me, that's a few inches of topsoil in an area that was depressed. So,
which would be fine.
I think we agree to
that. Which would be fine, right.
But leveling, you know, this area is supposed to be leveled. We want to create a level area.
It's different.
That's what they're asking. Right.
That's regrading it to a uniform grade.
Well, using the material that already exists in that area to level out that area to make
a yard.
See what more information you can get.
It wasn't what we were talking about. But that's why I did offer them to, let's change it up.
Yeah. Okay.
That's that.
Anything else? What about 34 Oak Street? We missed.
Well, I wasn't here for that, and it didn't come up, and the owner's not here, so I assume everything went fine.
Everything's fine.
Did the, what happened during the site visit?
Yeah, we don't have site visit report.
It's like Pandora's box, though. We opened up.
There's something, Chuck, that we need to follow up on, at least one thing, or two, at least two things. One is that the town of Reading is storing excess baseball or softball material
right
in such a way that every time it rains, it runs right into the wetland.
You can follow the trail right into the wetland.
So we've got to halt that.
That's at 34. Do you know? That's it. You know where that is?
I walked the site. I'm assuming it's where the opening in the gate is.
Correct.
Yes, exactly.
Correct.
And the other thing is the town of Reading has cut trees within the buffer zone without any notification, and they happen to be on the private property. But
So we think. I mean, it's not surveyed, so.
Well, yeah, it doesn't matter whose property it's on. It's certainly within the buffer zone.
It's within the buffer zone, and it's by occupation, it appears to be on their property, but
right.
It's not our
right.
Purview.
But the town did cut trees in violation of the bylaws and Wetland Act. And then the third thing is that people, there has been dumping, intentional large-scale dumping in the wetland in the form of a bridge or a
massive structure,
but they've taken a dozen or more pallets and placed them in the wetland,
making a boardwalk one of the roads to the school,
right? And we
cut through.
We would suspect that they're residents of Indian Court, so we should send a letter to them notifying them that that is a violation of the Wetlands Protection Act and the town bylaws.
There's also significant evidence of after I was drinking, I should say.
Yeah.
More than drinking.
Yeah, like there's probably more than drinking going on there.
Yeah, there's a toilet back there.
We could alert the police to.
So.
Evidence of that activity.
So we don't know where the access is, but it seems like there's pretty easy access from the school property because there's a massive opening, and you know there's a breach in the fence there that's 10 feet wide, and it would be the easiest way to go that I can see. It doesn't mean they're coming from there. I'm just saying. So these are issues that, you know, and this, all the stuff is deposited, some of which is deposited directly in the wetland. Like, not in the buffer zone, in the wetland.
Oh, yeah, floating around.
Cans.
So, this is a different situation than we usually. I mean, we have an owner who owns the property.
Right.
Who doesn't want it there.
Well, he doesn't want it there.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Usually, we have an owner who's doing this, and when we go after the owner,
right.
We have a willing owner right now. I believe and I think that he should manage that situation. I can say that it's a violation, it certainly is. But until he closes those fences off,
it's
right?
Not his fence. It's the town's fence.
That, it's not up to me
to
defend a private property owner. I can say not that right. That's in the wetland.
Right.
I think that.
But
property,
I don't have to go after people. It's
because what you're saying is that that pallet path is land owned by 34 Oak Street, but he hasn't fenced it yet.
Hold on, I can
is
even
what
go further.
You had said at a
when
previous
I
meeting.
When I went home, I looked at the GIS, and actually, a good majority of those pallets fall within a drainage easement.
A town drainage easement.
Correct.
Oh, really?
Correct. The drainage easement is from Indian, whatever the name of the
Indian Court.
Indian Court. There's a drainage easement that comes off the end of Indian Court that gets you into. You know where the fence went like this?
Mm-hmm.
I believe there's a drainage easement that comes around the back of that fence,
mm-hmm.
and there's probably a pipe in there. Oh no, it covers the stream. The stream that cuts through there.
Yes, probably.
Yeah.
Could.
But the access comes from Indian Court.
And it's a town easement.
It's a town easement according to the town GIS.
Okay.
Now, a good number of those pallets are in that easement.
And they're definitely in resource area.
I'm not saying they're the town's pallets. I'm just saying.
No, I'm not.
It's in
you know.
It's going to be the hardest thing to ever do to stop children from cutting through.
Well, I
oh, we're not talking about cutting through. We're talking about placing fill in the wetlands.
That's which is the pallets. They made made a boardwalk so they can get from one end to the other. Why don't we just permit it?
Because no application has been filed
for
the first reason.
That's right.
I think the owner would not like.
I just don't want to create a firestorm. Help me out here. What do you want me to do?
Well,
I think we need to post. I think we need to notify the residents of Indian Court that that's a violation of the Wetland Protection Act.
I mean, that's all we really have the purview to do.
Let me first ask the question: whose land is it?
Whose
land is it?
It's a number of people's land.
It's not.
Well,
it's not all his.
Says it's his.
It's not all his. Right. No,
part of it's on someone else's land.
Yeah, he said that it goes from the other person's land
right.
to his. And it's
right.
Like,
so some of it's on his. Some of it's on another person's land.
Well, I think. Let me step back. The erosion into the wetlands that can be addressed.
Correct.
Because
that is a town.
That's
action,
and that can be modified. That's a can-do sort of thing. The town cutting trees in the wetlands.
Buffer zone.
Buffer
not
zone.
Wetlands.
Wetlands buffer.
Right.
That also can be addressed. And, you know, with the meeting Chuck and I had, you know, I've got some...
Those trees made no sense to take down. I mean,
seems strange, yeah.
Yeah, looked odd.
Well, some of those were cut down because it was overhanging onto the field.
Oh, it was probably shading out the grass.
They just took a bunch out.
Could have been. But that's town, again, another town violation
that,
you know, we'll just add that to our list of town violations that, you know, we bring up.
Discuss.
The man-made pallet bridge in the wetlands by Indian Court. We could send a letter to Indian Court. That may or may not be the people who are doing that work.
That's right.
So,
we could just notify them.
Don't see it that way.
What's your perspective?
My perspective is that it belongs. That's not like town land. That's his land. We should send him a violation for having that in the wetland, even though
it's his land.
It's up to him
to police it.
Police his own land.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's.
I agree.
I
don't disagree with you. However, any place else in town where we see at the end of a street that there's yard waste dumped. We notify people on that street that that's a violation, because it is more likely than not they're the ones that are doing it. No matter whose land it's on, that's what we notify all those people.
And that becomes the group that keeps their eye out that this is a resource that has to be protected.
Right.
That alerts them.
We should just...
I mean
it would be even more
point,
effective just to go to the next assembly for that school and...
Right.
Make an announcement to everyone there.
I don't think that's it, because I think that some of the people hanging in there are not going to that school.
Probably not.
I saw those beer cans. They all seem to be pretty ancient. Was there?
They were ancient ones.
They
were new ones.
Five bags full.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were new ones.
I guess there were some new ones,
too. Well, you did have all those workers up there doing all that work. Maybe they got thirsty.
Yeah.
And
well,
I'm pretty sure it's not Joshua Eaton kids that are in there.
Well, that's it.
Cases
yeah.
I don't think they're using that.
You'd hope so.
They drink microbrews.
Right.
I think they're. I think notifying all the property owners and abutters is not. You know, it at least gets the word out to the people who are there regularly.
Or at least
we can get the owner of the property to start. Setting up some sort of obstacle or notification or
he's
alert
tried.
System.
He has tried. He built a fence and they cut it.
Yeah,
there's signs
they
everywhere.
Fence cutters and he would repair it and they take the fence cutters and cut it again and then he'd repair it again.
I mean,
and
this is serious stuff. We're not talking about, you know, some grade school kid coming. I mean, they got bolt cutters and they're cutting the fence, so. Why? What the heck is the point of that? It's just strange
to me.
I
just think we're
it's strange
going
to me.
Beyond. I mean, to take on his side and start...
On his side is protection of the resource.
I tend to.
But we could,
I can understand that.
But you're saying, I mean, it's on his property.
Correct.
That's the only person we know about. So I know to send him a letter.
Correct.
Saying to get it out of there and that he can't do
that. I would oppose that because he's tried everything he can, been unsuccessful. One more letter from us isn't going to do anything.
I mean, you don't know that as much as I don't know if who put the stuff in there. I mean, did he try? He told when I was out there, he said he wasn't going to do anything about it. He did show it to me.
And he's given up.
He has.
Yeah, and that's exactly what happens. People, the kids that do a cut through,
they beat you down.
They'll just keep coming.
They beat you down.
And I don't. I'm not saying we should not do anything about it.
So what are you suggesting?
I think it's suggesting we call it a boardwalk and call it a day.
I would have thought that
with a carry and carry out bag,
we would provide backup, but not be the lead person on such a thing.
Right.
Because I don't see that fence getting repaired on both sides or any attempt for this guy to put out the material. I mean, he told me he has a zip line down the bottom of the street, and that's on his property too. Has he sent them a notice?
He's talked to them before, and that also, they cut down trees to make that zip line, and they're dumping grass.
Yard waste. That.
This is like a 4 foot
like
pond.
Right, like it's huge. Side. And it's going right into the wetland.
I think.
And
I think
he has a gate
on his fence.
That's the
second issue, besides the sand going down.
Right.
So I think we've got a number of issues with this property owner that need to be addressed.
Three or four.
It's not the property owner, Anika.
But that's
he's
what Allison just described.
No.
The other property. It's like
other
way
property.
Where the zip line is, like way, way back there. And he
on
said
the, on the back side of the
he
line.
Said to
okay.
like the guy who's dumping said to
oh,
the
I understand.
To said to the wife was like, "This is conservation land. I can do whatever I want to it. It's not your property." That's what she told me. He said, "I don't know if that's true, but that's what
right.
she told me." And like that grass pile is huge.
It's huge. It's years and years and years.
And it's just a straight slope right to the wetland.
But just his attitude, it's not your land, it's conservation, so
I can do whatever I want.
Kind of raised my hackles right there.
All
right, anyway.
So we'll send out letters, but we won't. But that's it as far as.
Well, the town.
I can take it. No. Yeah, I guess
the town could do. We can.
If the town
anything
says
with
the
town is easy. I can.
Yeah.
I can deal with that.
Yeah.
Put the box around the dirt and take
and
care
we
of
can,
that.
And we can alert. We could alert the police. To the fact that we did know, just like there was paintball in Kirchian Woods. I mean,
that
you know,
was
in
town
this.
Land, though.
But isn't this town land?
No.
But the guy said it was conservation land.
No.
It's the jurisdiction.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
right.
He thinks
right.
it's
just,
not
he,
her land.
He doesn't right. think it's hers, and he just thinks it's like.
It's wetland, so it
doesn't
belong
matter.
To them.
Yeah.
So I can do what I want.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, I get
he
it. He just, yeah. Lisa's.
No, it's private
me.
Property. Even though there's a drainage easement there, I mean, obviously it's an easement. Someone else owns it, so.
I just want you guys to know that I have always not been the police for some private property owner, and I've said that to other people here in town. I've said, come on and see what my neighbor's doing.
Yeah.
And, well, that's your property. It is in the wetland,
right?
You can send a letter.
Yeah, we're not
kind of where I've been, so I.
We're being
right.
the police for the resource, not for his property.
Right,
right.
So if we want the town to maintain that fence that runs along the town property, because it's affecting the wetlands.
Well, I don't know if we can make him maintain the fence, but we can get them to stop storing the material
right there
the
at the top
into
of
the
right.
wetlands.
So they should
yes.
move that sand, and that guy should remove the debris.
Right.
At a minimum.
Right. And
yeah.
stop future.
But we really can't
deposition.
Tell the town to keep their stuff repaired because
right.
people are wrecking stuff.
Right.
I
right.
guess.
Right.
And the boardwalk, what would be the steps with that? What are you expecting? Can we have, so if I send out the letters, can I ask, I forgot his first name, but Mr. Conway, can I ask him to remove all those pallets?
Well, see,
I wouldn't.
He has done that, and then they just fill it up with more pallets.
Yeah, it's
and then he takes them out, and they fill them up again. So that's why he's kind of given up because he's got debris.
But I understand.
He
needs
to use land survey and talk to the cops about
it. It's his property.
It's
he needs to assert his ownership on the property.
Yeah, I agree with you, Chuck.
He's a lawyer too.
It's his land.
Well, that's the big one. That's the big one.
The what?
The big one. If he believes that people are accessing. His property from town property, and he believes that he's been wronged. He needs to take that up with the appropriate people with his own.
So yeah. I walk from one end to the other, and you know what I didn't see?
What?
private property stay off.
Oh, no, he's got tons of them.
He's got tons of them. We saw half a dozen.
They're not new.
On the fence on this side, but not on that.
No, it's all over the place. And they're not new.
We saw at least half a dozen of them.
They're not new. No, no, I saw
it. I walked in from Joshua Eaton, and I saw at least two.
Yeah.
But on this, so you walk from Joshua Eaton, and they get the fence on this side, where his house is up there.
Yeah.
I didn't see any.
There is. They're all along those trees.
Really?
Actually, out towards the bridge.
Yeah.
And out on the other side, too, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've saw it.
I mean, it's out there.
We spent almost 2 hours there, or at least an hour.
Yeah.
At least an hour.
This must have been something his father-in-law put out there years ago.
The fence was, yeah.
Well, the fence, the signs, all that stuff, because then he kind of stopped doing it.
I found a ninja star.
Did you really?
Did you really?
Oh, that's right.
You found a ninja star?
Yep.
Yeah, there's a ninja star out there, which is a pretty nasty one.
Not that.
Did you throw it further into them?
Threw it into a tree.
Oh, yeah.
A dead one.
A nasty one, huh?
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Couple of rows of
by survivalists here.
They're definitely going to come back to us and ask. So what are we going to tell them to do? Like.
And I think if we write them a letter saying you got to clean all this mess up, is
they're just going to be like,
that's not good.
So I mean, I think I feel for these guys, but it's their private land. They have to take the initiative. We can support them more and stuff, but I think we don't go in and start telling them.
Right. A couple of rows of
you saw that parcel and that house. He has other priorities.
Yeah.
Right. There's other things that need to be changed on the property.
He's got plenty to do there.
This guy, he bit off an awful lot moving back in there.
Well.
Couple of rows of concertina wire, I'll fix that.
So
there won't be anybody crossing through there.
Still letters to, it was that Indian
court.
Indian court.
Definitely letters over there. Now, I didn't go to that corner over there, so there's access to this area from Indian court.
Yeah,
right. Is there
access, clear access, yeah.
Access from other areas as well, or just people's backyards?
No,
I think it's mostly Indian court.
From the street,
there's a
cul-de-sac right there.
Cul-de-sac Indian court, right besides there. The Indian court area.
I don't think so.
I think it's just
we didn't see any.
That's
we
the main
look on a map.
Yeah, that's it. They go across. Yeah.
Okay. Who owns the fence? Do you suspect it's
the town owns one fence and the property owner owns another fence.
So it would be nice to send out the letters, have the fence fixed, and then remove the debris. And then whoever's doing this would have to start from scratch.
Correct.
Put the fence again.
Correct.
Put down pallets.
Correct.
You know.
Yep.
This
noticeable by a younger person who lives in the house now who can monitor that property.
The thing is, removing those pallets is
take note.
Is no trivial matter.
I'm telling you that bridge took days to build.
Yeah.
And it washed downstream.
I didn't go all that far down. I just went past all the pallets and stuff. But there's a
There was a bridge.
It was like 80 feet downstream.
Washed down.
And this wasn't an Eagle project. Right?
No, this was a massive bridge. This took.
Wow.
There was some serious wood brought in for this thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
this was not a pallet. This was like a constructed bridge.
And we don't think the Joshua Eaton third graders built it.
I really don't think so.
Well, if anybody wants to take up the matter and build a bridge, they know where to come, I hope.
Yeah.
Talk. So.
I would drive my motorcycle over that bridge. I'm serious.
Yeah,
that's how stout this
bridge
was. It was.
Sounds like some dad's bridge.
Just saying.
So that's 34 Oak.
And the only other thing that happened this week was the right of way trimming. I think we solved that, but I'm going to check that out tomorrow or Friday.
No more epicormic branches.
No.
Okay. Zero Haverhill Street?
It's history.
History. Okay. Okay. Anything else? What about the minutes? Oh, I saw the tree cutting policy. I think it looks good.
I think there is a typo in it. Maybe I'm wrong. Number one, first sentence, the Town of Reading Conservation Commission shall issue an enforcement order to both the owner of the property and or contractor. I think it should be, shall issue an enforcement order to the
owner of the property and/or contractor.
So just take out both.
Just take out both.
Okay.
The owner of the property.
Strike both.
And/or.
Okay.
Strike the word both.
Correct. Right. The word both.
Okay.
What's this violation of this policy may be punishable by death? What?
Yes, by death.
Oh, I thought it was torture. I thought we only authorized torture.
While we're on this one, did we sort of, at least symbolically ratify this policy?
I think we did.
The last.
We did.
Oh, we did.
The last meeting? Okay. All right. Good then. So, minutes?
I move we accept the meeting's minutes from the last meeting as issued.
Okay, is motion seconded? Okay, all those in favor? Okay.
I abstain, I was not here.
Okay. Any other matters here?
Brian?
What?
You said you'd think about it.
Yeah, I'm not talking about it right now.
You wanna enumerate to the rest of us?
No, I mean, Will's not here, so.
Is this the So you're not going to talk about something?
The election of officers is on the agenda.
Yeah, I think we need to wait till everybody's here to discuss it.
Well, we have a quorum, but you want to wait until we actually have a full attendance.
I think that's since one of the considerees is Will.
Okay.
I think he should probably be here for the discussion.
Well, let's
change to the 8th.
Let's move this to the agenda item.
Unless someone else wants to talk about it, that's just my opinion. I mean,
well, it just yeah, sure. Let's move it on. I just am wondering when we're gonna have everybody here. You know.
Oh well, right. I mean, if you want to discuss it, we can discuss it. I mean, I just don't think for me personally,
We can move it to the 8th.
Okay, yeah, let me, yeah.
We all better be here next time.
Well, we'll see. Otherwise, we'll see if people want to move it to the next one.
I know I will not be here on the 8th.
Well, more specifically, since Will is one of the eligible candidates, I think if we're going to discuss it, he should be here.
Absolutely.
Does that make sense?
That makes sense.
Mm-hmm. I suppose Jamie's technically an eligible candidate too, so he's not going to be here on the 8th.
Well, not by our new unwritten policy of inviting candidates.
Right.
What unwritten?
Because you're a chairman of recent past.
Right. Right. We try and rotate through as the unwritten policy.
It's not a policy till it's written.
Yeah.
That's my opinion, but it's only my opinion. So why don't we continue this election issue until maybe we can just say only to be discussed if full membership is present.
We should implement a free strike rule.
That if we don't get to something on the agenda 3 times, it's off.
Yeah,
because, I mean, just from...
How about if we don't get this done, the Conservation Commission will shut down?
Well, from...
So you guys love to talk.
I will voice.
All I
mean,
have to say.
Could you pass those to?
Oh gosh, yeah.
I agree.
Non-essential members will not be able to be at this meeting.
I mean, from my standpoint, I'll just say that, you know, as chair since last summer, since I got voted in, I've been putting in a fair amount of time on a regular basis to make sure I meet with Chuck. And I've been meeting with people in town hall, and I feel like we're getting some traction with certain other town entities. And I think if we can keep our efforts consistently moving forward, especially in the realm of town communication, inter-office communication, and pushing for, especially recently, some of our discussions have included, at least between Chuck and I, have included a push to try and get Chuck some more hours. with a number of discussions with John Fudo and Gene Delios about that. You know, if there's a new chair voted, I would want to make sure that I conveyed over to that new chair a lot of those efforts that I've put forward in the last year, and, you know, hope that they continue, because I think it's moving the Conservation Commission in a better direction. So with that, any other agenda items?
Well, I just wondered, when we were talking before about, Chuck had mentioned maybe we should have longer terms, and because of the continuity, do we want to talk about that at all? Do we wait for that for next time too?
I'd entertain moving that discussion too to the next time. I'm like, why don't we just take care of it all at once, okay, and people can continue to think about it and
is there a written policy or is this an unwritten policy? How did it get established and what was behind it?
The selectmen had the policy that they rotated chair of the board of selectmen, and they recommended to other committees and commissions they follow that same policy. And there have been problems, particularly with the Conservation Commission, where a person becomes entrenched as chair and causes big problems. And a number of years ago, it got to the point where the Board of Selectmen had to remove her from the commission, and she filed suit against the town and won, and the town had to pay her a big pot of money.
How long was she the chair?
Will would know off the top of his head, but
like 10 years or
something? No, I think it was 4 or 5 years. And Bill was chair for 3 years, 4 years, and it became an issue in town. And we want to avoid that. The idea at one point was that you had a chair and you had a vice chair, and they worked together, and the vice chair was up on everything that was going forward, and then that vice chair slipped into chair, and the new vice chair came in, so there was a succession plan, if you will.
Yeah.
And I think that's a good approach. The conversation that you've been having with the other town, we're not aware of, and I think that's a problem.
Well, I'd be more than welcome to...
With another town?
No, not with another town. With,
oh, with
discussions
the town.
I'm having
right,
within the town. And some of these discussions I have relayed to the commission during past meetings. I don't mind giving a regular chair report. I think a lot of the business during the meetings, all our permitted business, has taken up a good bulk of our time in hashing out all of those issues. And, you know, maybe selfishly, I've sort of wanted to get home and get some rest. We've had some really late meetings lately. So, you know, and maybe I should put it on the agenda that, you know, it should be chair's business and update everybody at every meeting about what is happening, because I've also been in the position of not being chair and hearing things from the chair's mouth and figuring out, wait, there have been other discussions I'm not privy to. I'd like to know what's really happening and what decisions, what the thought process is that the chair's going through, and what a little summary of what some of those behind-the-scenes discussions have been. So I recognize what you're saying, and I'd be happy to add that to the next agenda. But some of the business also is simply a matter of time, you know, and wanting to let people get home and not hearing, honestly, that sentiment spoken out loud. And so I'm glad you did. So, that said, any other comments or questions? Or
one other thing.
Yeah.
We're talking about having a meeting of MAP for the pipeline coming up next week. I don't know if anybody was interested on that. It's Tuesday, 7:30.
This is the gas pipeline that's coming through from Canada.
The meeting is in Shelburne.
Shelburne?
Yes.
Okay.
Past Greenfield.
Come on.
It's probably an hour and a half.
Shelburne Falls.
Shelburne Falls.
Where they have that flower bridge.
It's actually
beautiful.
It's a one block from the flowing bridge is where the meeting is.
But that's a hell of a place to have the meeting.
Each way, so, I mean, I was thinking about going, but it's a long way.
Yeah, the Bridge of Flowers is what it's called.
It, actually, it's not a bad motorcycle ride if you got about 2 days.
That's right.
I've gone there and back a lot.
So I assume that nobody is interested in attending that or available to attend that. Maybe we'll...
We should send someone before I get back.
It is beautiful out there. Can I put it on my expense report if I go?
You can deduct the mileage from your income tax.
Yeah, only when you get past a certain amount. But, I think.
But wasn't that coordinator going to come before each commission?
He was, but there's
talked
a lot of commissions
that.
And the final route hasn't been figured out.
Because
so.
I requested to be put on that email.
Further east
later on, once
that route gets more finalized,
right.
Yep.
That we would request to have a meeting of like the eastern group or whatever.
I think that makes sense. So
FO East or something. Whether, you know.
Thanks for letting us know. It would be good if somebody did go. I can't promise it's me.
I
can't
go.
Huh?
I have class. I can't go.
I know some
class?
People in the area who are going to go.
Okay.
Yeah.
Depends on my energy level on Tuesday.
All right.
That's right.
Well, if somebody does go, please let us all know.
Yeah.
We should televise it.
Some nice places.
That would be great. Webcast
too.
It.
Sure.
That would be really
very
great.
Nice places. Yeah.
That would be really great. Was there anything else? Kim's packing up, so
no,
is there?
No, I'm listening.
There?
You guys are just chatting.
Yeah, all right.
I got my notes.
The sense of turn is false.
She wishes we would stop.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm just kidding.
Any other business? Hearing none. Okay. Motion to adjourn.
I'm motion to adjourn.
Okay, seconded.
Second.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. Eugene Benson, that's the guy.
Yeah, this is what right here.
Now I'm the president.
Eugene Benson.
Very proud of him.
You know where he lives and stuff.
No. Don't go that far.
Okay. All right. Well, hey, it's not even 11. That's not too bad.
Steps on.